Sup?
We're back.
We're back again. And Andrew's dressed like an adult.
I am dressed like an adult.
How'd that happen?
Because I have to do meetings with my school.
You can't do that with like anime print shirts?
I probably could, but you know, I'm trying to show them that I'm not like the insane human being they think I am for some reason. I don't want to give them any more reason to be like, yeah, maybe not this guy.
Your goal is like, well, after I've talked to that guy, he must be an eccentric billionaire.
I just like look like Mark Zuckerberg.
He just gets another degree every 6 months for fun.
Who's the one who does that? It's what's this fucking actor's name? The guy who just did The Room. Remember his name? The guy who just played
James Franco.
James Franco. He has like, I think like 3 degrees, and he's gotten all of them while acting, and he's like, I also got like I got like my master's degree, and I also taught students, and I also like did, I got like the highest score.
I imagine with acting
score.
Jobs, you have like downtime a lot between.
Well, yeah, but it was like,
where it's like, I'm between, like, I'm just, you're just between work. So it's like, I guess I'll just get a degree now.
But he was pulling top of the class stuff. And like, I was like, what is this? What are your purpose? Like, why even get degrees? Because like at the end of the day, what are you going to do with them?
It's learning stuff.
Yeah, but I think there were like some of them were in science and stuff. I was like, you're going to join a STEM field at the end of the day, Franco?
I mean, learning stuff's fun.
Yeah.
I like school.
It's just interesting to put the kind of money that goes into school.
Yeah.
Like, he's...
Well, it's like, I like being a student more than I like getting, like, the process of winning at being a student.
Yeah.
Like, it's around the time you're doing the tests and the homework as opposed to, like, lectures and exercises and stuff where it's just like, wow, let's just do this thing where I ruin my weekend to regurgitate some information to then not even retain it, probably.
Yeah,
like that kind of stuff.
Either not need it because I can access that information in a better, more efficient way, or
the school system can like ruin stuff that you like.
Yes.
Like you could like a particular thing and it still goes horribly in the process of the test thing. Or even if you do well, you're just like, this was horrible.
Yeah.
This is what I like to do.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of parts of being a student that are actually really enjoyable, and it feels good to go through that stuff in general.
I feel like that's a very mixed bag, though. It depends on the kind of schooling you're doing and what, like...
But if you're an incredibly wealthy dude with tons of free time, then, like, getting degrees for the hell of it, like, sure, why not? Like,
yeah,
you
I
literally
guess.
Have... Like, there's other people who are like, oh my god, I have to do my 2 separate shifts of Subway and McDonald's just to afford the commute to school, and I'm never going to be able to pay for the textbooks for the next 20 years of debt and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But for those people, it's like, this is a whole miserable experience. But if you're just an incredibly rich dude with free time, then suddenly it's like, yeah, let's just get degrees. It's easy.
School seems fun.
Because, surprise, most of college isn't that hard.
No.
It's more the several life difficulties surrounding the idea of what's essentially a prolonged childhood, because that's kind of the ask.
Yeah.
You know that high school? What if it just keeps going forever?
Yeah, what if your parents just foot the bill for you existing for like another 4 or 5 years, if possible?
Years.
Don't be a doctor, though, because then they'll never stop paying for you.
So I'd say it's either you have to do the incredible, like... School's just it's an insane concept in a lot of ways. Like, yes, you're either prolonging your childhood and being a dependent for years and years and years and years, which even the people that encourage you to do that are often not actually sure understanding what that means until it actually happens. And then suddenly they turn on you and you're like, the fuck, you told me to do this. Or the alternative is you become one of the people that has to just kill themselves in the process of like, you're always working and always in school and you can't sleep and everything's fucked.
Yeah, it's an interesting concept that I feel is really backwater compared to America. Like, America shouldn't have that problem, as it's like it's a country that not only...
You mean because our economic level and everything and our power, we shouldn't be this fucked.
The citizen shouldn't struggle to learn. It's not like one of the problems a first world country ever faces.
Which why you look, like, it's hard to look at those like European countries where like you just get paid to be a student. It's like, just do this, because we realize that if we put, because in American values, it makes no sense to do that because we're thinking like, the fuck? They're not contributing to society. They're not currently producing GDP. Why are they getting money? So that's the only way we can assign worth, and because we have no idea how to run anything.
Yeah.
Just, and it's just like how like we hate the idea of like putting money towards like criminal systems or any sort of like healthcare reform or anything that can help. Like we hate putting money towards things that don't immediately have dividends, but actually do help all of society as a whole and actually improve the GDP ultimately in non-direct, harder to measure ways that are actually still concrete as shit. If you listen to people that know how to measure that stuff,
or you just look at like the 50 other countries doing it and still afloat.
Like you look at education, it's like, wow, look how all this education people have, like, reduces crime and improves the, like, percentage of people that are skilled workers and, like, all these other things. It literally makes everything better for everyone. And suddenly, like, oh, that's why they just pay you to be a student.
Yeah.
Because their profit, as a society as a whole, and even in their own back pocket, they are profiting off of that.
Yeah, they will profit off you.
As opposed to our system, which is, you want to be a student, you're going to have to fucking kill yourself the whole time. You're going to be burning yourself at fry cook places and shit, and you're going to sleep 3 hours a night, and you're only going to retain information for 3 days at a time because you're so fucked at trying to even be a functioning human being. And if you don't manage to get in a car crash in all this process, then congratulations, you have 30 years of debt. Fuck you.
You basically,
and also there's no jobs anyway, so congrats, you're right back to the fry cook job, but also with the debt for the thing that didn't do anything, and you're like, this works.
it's impressive, because like, I'll be real with you for a second. I'll talk to you very really. My home, this home that we're currently recording this podcast
the
in,
green room,
this yeah
teal
this
room
teal room, this entire estate costed me $200,000 to purchase. And that is under the impression that for the next 30 years of my life, I will pay this home at a very minimal amount of money per month.
Mm-hmm.
When you go to school here, you pay almost $100,000 to go to school. You pay what equates to half the value of my home. And then they expect you to go, well, thank you. Thank goodness it was so affordable for me as a person to afford. Because, like, I'm an average person and I need it to get a job to buy a home that's $200,000. So thank goodness you let me take out a 30-year loan for $100,000 so that I can be prepared for when I need to buy an actual home 30 years from now.
The scale is so insane.
It's
especially when you think about like the actual reasonable cost of the system.
Yeah.
Does not equate at all to what they're charging.
No, it's
like
each
room is one person being paid to lecture like 30 to 200 people.
Yes.
And you're going to tell me that everyone there has to be paying like $5,000 a unit or whatever the fuck, like some insane sums of money while also still having to buy their own books. And you have to buy the new books because we changed the punctuation a few places. And more importantly, they added DRM to college.
Yeah.
College has DRM now, which is that you can't use the old book because every book comes with a CD key, basically, to do the online part of the course. And you literally can't do the class without the code. Period.
Yeah.
So these affordable options of being able to buy last year's textbooks for like $5 because it's just fucking paper and it's everywhere because everyone's a student, so the supply is out there. No, we need to create a system of waste in every way possible, because we couldn't just do what all high schools do and all elementary schools do, where we use the same books for like 20 fucking years until something actually changes.
Yeah.
No, we can't even use last year's books, even though they're everywhere. They've got to burn them all now because they're worthless. They're just paperweights, and we made all of those every year, so we can make them all every year, keep this industry firing, because why make any of this reasonable?
And for those Europeans who are appalled and aghasted at the sound of this, do not fret. If you are in the situation where you cannot afford a new book, you can just buy a CD key.
And just do the class without the book.
Yes. But by the way, the CD key is half the cost of the book buying it new. Because that's why you're buying the book. It's just for that CD key. You're not buying the book for the book. No one ever cares about the book.
It's absurd that the whole digital course part, where you take the online element, is being added to the in-classroom part.
Yes.
It's literally just a tool to make the job easier for the teacher. And yet it makes the class more expensive for us instead of less expensive, even though it's making the class easier to do.
Yeah, that was one of the focuses of why I chose the school that I did, was because I don't have to buy books.
Mm-hmm.
Because their idea was like, well, it's 100% online, so we just took our library and put it online.
Yeah, go ahead and tell them your strategy you're doing right now.
For those
why you're dressed like this will be the crescendo of that.
Yes, for those who don't know, I've mentioned a couple of times now, I've been doing schooling to go get a bachelor's degree. Because, surprise, surprise, I own a home and don't have a bachelor's. Those millennials, fucking lazy! And so, I'm going through and getting a bachelor's and doing it 100% online because I am a busy man and hate people. So combined together makes online classes a beautiful existence in my life.
Yeah.
And the difference between a normal online class and the class that I'm doing is that most online classes go through the college schedule, which is you go to class on these specific days, you have due dates at these specific times for these specific things. Where what I'm doing is it's all... You go is whenever it's best for you, because you're a busy man. You have a job. We expect you to be able to only do, you know, you have a family, a life. You can only do like a couple hours of classes a day. We can't really expect that. Well,
where the trap they're going for is the idea that you're going to pay per semester, but if their target demographic is people that have less time than normal for school.
Yes.
So they're going to take even longer. So they even pay more ultimately.
So their ultimate strategy here is that it will take you roughly around, it should take you around 2 to 3 years to complete, I think it's like 120 units.
That sounds about right.
Yeah. And so, and each semester, which is 6 months, they give you, each semester is only, is four classes. And so that's the plan that they have for you, is that it should take you it should take you 6 months to complete four college classes. And they charge you based on semester instead of by, they don't charge you for class, they charge you semester to semester. So it's a flat rate.
Yeah.
And so every 6 months,
and you should specify by semester, you mean interval of time.
Yes. Interval of time. Mm-hmm. So every 6 months is a semester. It
basically has the billing model of an MMO.
Yes, basically. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so much like when I play an MMO, I decided to say, well, I can take advantage of a 30-day free trial when and get to the max.
When you bought
character.
The special edition boxed set of Old Republic and then beat the game in like the starting time and never paid for a single month.
Yeah.
After that.
Yeah. I think
your edition came with 3 months.
3 months
it was
free.
The big box thing.
Yeah. I think
and we had the rage-filled moment of realizing that I paid for the game nonstop all the way until it went free-to-play, and you had more of the currency than I did.
Yeah.
Because they valued you as a person who bought the special edition and never played the game after that point higher than me, somebody who was a loyal subscriber the entire run of the game,
and
having
by,
a subscription. I had less of the premium currency as my reward for being a loyal customer.
And by loyal, he means I literally... didn't play after 3 months
because
I had already beaten the game.
You never paid a single monthly subscription.
No, I never paid a single cent to them besides the box.
They thought you should get more points than me.
Yeah. Oh,
fucks.
And so I took that approach to college. And I said, okay, you give me 6 months. I could pay this much. I'll be done with a bachelor's in 6 months. And against all of their opposition, which was like, no, please. That's not a good idea. It's really stressful. I decided, no, I'll do that. So,
because when has Andrew ever been stressed?
Never. But I took it upon myself to just been doing that, which is every I basically wake up every morning and spend about 8 to 9 hours doing school before I go to work. And so
basically they're freaking out because you're treating college like how actual college students treat actual college.
Yes.
Is that it takes up all of their time and they lose their minds.
Well, that's the thing is that
like, that's how normal college is.
Well, yes, but normal college,
like, don't treat this like normal college. You have to take it easy and go to the spa.
Yeah.
Like, take your time.
And, I mean, the other thing too, is that normal college has the hindrance that you cannot, that you can't just hyper-focus a class down.
Yeah.
So you can't just beat a class in a submission.
You're literally focusing a class at a time.
Yes. So
just beating that one class.
Yeah, so basically...
It's like their ads on a boss.
Basically. And so my strategy has been every...
This podcast is becoming a raid leader's guide to online college.
Yeah, exactly. if you want to take advantage of getting a bachelor's degree...
The problem is that if you beat all these ads too quickly, you get the administration's aggro.
Yeah.
And that's why he's dressed like this.
You get the final boss a little too quick. My plan of action was, or what I had been doing, was that every 3 days I finished a college class.
Mm-hmm.
This
podcast is really going to fuck up with a lot of people's perspective of who you are as a person. Like, this persona you've developed for like 6 years now. Like those people are going to be like, the fuck?
Don't worry, guys. I'm not doing like a math major. So I'm not.
No, you couldn't.
No.
You could not.
So it's not I'm sitting here being.
I've tutored you through word problems before. It's not going to happen.
Yeah, that was not good. But doing basically a college, so you think about that as students that you may be, some of you, I'm doing one of your classes every 3 days. And it sounds absurd, but the administration thought so too, was that that's not okay. This human should probably dedicate more time to being alive rather than school.
They're dedicating human resources to trying to stop you.
Yes. So they implemented a very curious strategy, which was at first what they wanted was that I would have to, what was it that I needed to, it's like they wanted me to slow down. By like trying to delay, it was like trying to delay how many courses I could do, basically. Mm-hmm. So they're like, this is how many things you can do per week. And then that didn't work because I was like, no, that's not, that's like literally not part of the agreement here.
Yeah,
like,
you can't just make up new rules. After I've already paid.
Yeah, after I've already paid. So then they said, okay, well, we have a thing for online classes where mm-hmm. we have for the at your own pace thing, but just for regular online students, they said, well, we have a thing what we do, which is in order to submit your final, you have to complete these, like, the teachers will ask you questions where they'll be like, hey, so what do you think about this topic? And it's like, give me an explanation that's not three pages, but it's not three sentences kind of thing. And so, yeah, say you're learning psychology and it's like, well, what do you think about, you know, Schrodinger's cat's experiment? And you're like, okay.
Teasers for VLR.
Yes, and so...
Because I don't think that's come up in your class.
No, I'm not taking psychology classes. But the idea is, basically,
you going to tell us about Radical 6 yet?
No.
Did you have to write an essay on Radical 6?
No, thanks. I'm good.
How many Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles quotes did you do?
All of them. The idea was that I have to do those. I have to submit those things to them. And the teachers they are allowed up to 3 days to reply.
I'm guessing they always take those 3 days.
Surprisingly, yeah. They seem very busy. So then my counter strategy was...
I bet you they immediately write their response and then like queue it up for a 3 day like response time.
Well, no, it's not even... They don't write a response back. They just say whether it was acceptable or not. So they just have it sitting there as it just a document that they just have to go like, yeah, that's fine.
And even then, while that's happening, you could just be doing the other class.
Which is what I started doing.
Exactly.
And it started getting to a point.
Because the 3 days sounds a lot like the time you take to do a class. So you'll just finish a class then and then get approved on whether or not you could do the other class.
Yeah. And so the problem with that is by having that system was the goal in mind was, okay, it would slow them down because until the teachers approve, I can't do the final for the classes. I literally cannot finish the class.
So now you're just cramming the other class while hopefully being able to still do the final.
No.
You're able to do the final.
Their mistake was that that there are two different types of classes. There's classes that end with a test, like a final.
Yeah.
Like a multiple choice question. And there's another, and there's other classes that end with a project. So an essay or some kind of like, you know, basically project kind of thing. The projects, you can have access to them early. You can see like what the project is. You just can't submit it. So I would start, I singled out, when they started doing that, I singled out all the classes that were project based and would start doing them. So that way, by the time I'm waiting for the teachers, I have the final done. And then the moment that they approve, boop, there's a final. And I just would go through.
So you can see the final?
Yeah, I can.
It's not like a timed final.
No, it's because it's project based. So the ones that are a test, I can't do until they approve.
Yeah.
But the projects I can do.
Say, like, that's a lot of time given to you to do a test. It almost like you'd get every answer right to give an infinite time to check.
Exactly. So they and so I was I just started doing that where I was like only doing the project based ones and then submitting them. So it was they would go like, okay, I approve all the things Andrew did. Oh, his final's here. Fuck. Like that was
almost
real...
like it didn't delay you at all.
Exactly. And so their next implementation was like, okay, well, now we're a little suspicious if you're actually the one doing these things, because you're doing it very efficiently, almost like you have some kind of team. Sweatshop. Yeah, like a sweatshop going out of like
sounds like you should have thought about all these holes in your system before you made it.
Well, okay, I want to
because yes, people could just not actually earn their degree in this format.
Well, but here's the thing, is that most people are genuinely, like, not going to do that. Most people are going to be like, I'll take my time.
Yeah, that's their business model.
Yeah. And so then it became a thing of like, okay, well, now we're not...
Because you're essentially the person that's trying to play a free-to-play game without ever spending any money on it.
Yeah, basically.
So it's... They're pulling all their stops to stop you.
Yes.
Where you're hitting level 300 of Candy Crush and it just feels impossible every time you play it.
Yeah.
But maybe one day the RNG...
And so now they started doing, the next thing they did was with tests. Before it was just you take a test online, you know, like you would with anything. And then, now they were dubious and started doing a thing where I need to record the test. I need to record myself taking the test, to show that I'm not cheating on the test.
It sounds like they're making up rules just for you.
No,
probably.
Well, for, I'm the only one in the pace, like at your own pace, that it has to adhere to the same rules that the online college students have to.
It's like you're beating two colleges at once.
Yes, basically. And so... so dumb.
You're getting dual-wield specialization.
Yeah, and so on top of all that, they decided to, at the end of the week, because I'm completing, at this point, because of the shackles that bind me now, I'm hindered to the point where I can only complete two classes every week.
Does that work for you, schedule-wise, or is that going to put you behind?
It's fine-ish. Like, it's I'm not going to be able to... Because my goal was I wanted to spitefully complete before the 6 months was up.
So have they beaten you in that term?
I think it will probably... I think it might take me, like, 4 to 5 months to complete it now, if it goes this way.
Because he was trying to beat the entirety of college in 1 month payment, period.
One single payment for 6 months.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I wanted to get a bachelor's in 6 months.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, if I complete, I technically will be the record holder at that school for the fastest person to get a degree.
I can see why, because they try really hard to stop you.
Yes, and I'm not giving it up, because the other person that got it, it took him 15 months to complete school, and...
So you're beating that person by, like, 9 months.
Yes.
If you make it.
And he's, like,
And the only reason you're not making it, potentially, is because they're nailing your feet into the ground.
So if I win, I'll be spitefully happy to receive the award of the fastest
student.
The
idea of you beating college out of spite is incredible.
It's
you are so this is really fitting because so one of the reasons you were removed from the previous podcast was your you went on a spiteful rant against college just as a concept.
Yes.
And Wander was live streaming it, and, like, the audience was turning on you, and the other co-hosts of the podcast were turning on you. Right now I'm uploading the Soulsborne playthrough that you did.
Yeah.
Where you're spitefully learning Dark Souls and, like, beating it out of spite, basically. So the idea that these two things would come together, and, like, now you're doing, like, the Soulsborne playthrough of college, where you're just like, I still hate this thing, it's all bullshit, and no one should ever have to do this, but also I'm going to beat it faster than anyone ever has, because fuck you. It's just, it's almost like you're beating it just to further earn the right to shit talk.
Yeah, I do. I kind of feel good about it, because not only do I get to meet people who have bachelors now, and they're like, oh, I got a bachelor's. Like, oh, really? How long did that take you? Because it took me 6 months. And they're like, well, I took, loser. College is a waste. And I can walk away, and they can't argue with me because a man beat it in 6 months and called it garbage. He's right.
We're all going to soon have to deal with the idea of Andrew being somebody who got a bachelor's degree in less than a year.
I'm the kind of
another. And it's just going to be another thing on the week. Like, if you wonder what the fuck this is, it's like it's been like 6 or 7 years of just observing this bizarre, entertaining psychology of this bizarre person. I'm just like, what drives you? What the fuck is happening?
I'm the kind of person that if I were to get cancer and then beat it, I would spitefully talk about that all the time. I would be the kind of person that would go to funerals of people who died of cancer and be like, I guess he wasn't strong enough because I beat it, and then just walk away. It's not even my funeral. I don't even know the guy. I would just go there to insult him for losing the fight because I beat it. And I would have a t-shirt on. It says, I beat cancer. How about you? And then if people said like, well, no, I currently have it. Well, you better fight harder because then you can't be on my level.
Like I got through college without any debt.
That's impressive.
It was luck.
Well, did you have
so much of it?
It was like financial aid and scholarships.
So some of it was me being a good student, and some of it was just insane, bizarre luck, and some of it was the life decisions of people around me affecting me.
Huh.
Like, in unpredictable ways that were not, like, almost like it was a weird political strategy. Like, if you look at the background of how I got to college, it looks like the steps that are taken to make somebody president, and, like, all the weird machinations and...
House of Cards college?
Yes. There's some House of Cards shit going on in my history of how I got through college. And it's fucking weird to look
at.
So what happened is I was a good student in high school and all school, period. I was always on the honor roll forever. I was never a valedictorian because I didn't care.
What do you have to do for that?
A valedictorian is straight A's.
Forever. Oh, it's just all straight A's.
All straight A's.
Okay, I thought there was something more to it. Like, I thought you had to take special classes and...
No. There's a valedictorian, and then there's something else where it's like you got one B as, like, the something else is Victorian or whatever. We had, like, one of those.
So there's, like, a
My graduating class had, like, 12 valedictorians.
What? Are you serious? Mine had, like, couple...
One of them was Mr. Lewis's daughter.
Both her parents are teachers. Like, what?
At that school.
How do you? Yeah, like, how do you even? You can't even lie. You can't be like, I didn't have homework because Mr. Lou just called the teacher and be like, did she not have homework today?
Yeah, like, it's funny. I felt all inadequate at graduation because there was like 12 valedictorians and there was that one guy that got like a $400,000 like piloting scholarship and stuff like that, like that kind of stuff.
Excuse me, what?
Which is funny because at the end they were announcing all like the grants and scholarships that everyone got in this one. It wasn't the graduation, but like a separate ceremony thing about that stuff. And they had this total, and then you realize that like more than half of their total was just that number the one dude, and it wasn't a real monetary scholarship. It was he's getting a free ride through a thing that would technically be worth this much money. Like, the money wasn't changing hands in the first place.
Okay.
So it's like, it was a weird lie.
Yeah, they didn't give him, like, $400,000 to go to any school he wanted. They're like, it was specifically, like, here's a gift card for flight school.
Yeah.
Basically.
But I always enjoyed, but wasn't dedicated to school.
Yeah,
I always just took to high school naturally.
You did what you needed to do without struggling, nor without being lazy about it.
In fact, being the piece of shit I am, I would go home and like watch fucking like cartoons or play video games or go hang out with friends, wake up in the morning like an hour early and do all of my homework and then go to school.
Wow.
And all of my homework every day was the morning of the day it was due.
That's impressive.
Including entire essays. Like, I actually can't relate to people that need a bunch of time to write an essay.
Oh, yeah.
I can just write the essay.
Yeah, I can just... I have that problem, too, where, like, my sister does that, where she's like, I don't know what to write, and it's like, just say the thing.
If it's not a research paper or something, I can just write the essay on the spot.
If you're just,
I don't even have to proofread it, then the entire format comes naturally, all the way down to, like, the way that you need to, like, do paragraphs and, like, the thesis and everything.
Yeah.
I can just spew that shit out.
Yeah.
In fact, I wrote an essay in 10 minutes once that won a competition between all of the other people, because we did a history thing where everyone wrote papers anonymously.
Okay.
We had, I think you had 1 hour to write the papers, and I wrote mine in like 10 minutes and left. And it won.
And left.
And it won.
Like, I just...
and it's just won. Like, I just... The only close thing that I had to a criticism of the entire paper was that I said the word man too much, so somebody thought I was misogynist or something. But it was like, I was using man in place of, like, one. Like, talking about... I was just talking about, like, humanity, essentially.
Yeah, you're shorthanding humanity.
And I don't remember the actual fucking essay anymore, but it was just like, I was just running with a thought. And
yeah,
I was just like, fucking spin this philosophical yarn and just fucking leaving. And
then
we spent like the next week doing like a paper tournament where the papers were showing off against each other. And I'm just sitting there in the background like, what the fuck is happening? Oh my God, it's going to win.
What was that?
Benoit?
Oh, it was for English.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's English.
Yeah.
It had to be English. Otherwise, it'd have to have content. It wouldn't be done in 10 minutes. Also, not that many essays in the other classes, usually. We didn't write a lot of, like, economics essays in high school.
When you said history, I was like, the only teacher I could think of would be that much of a dick is Kenyon. Because he's, like, passionate about history.
We had some angry people.
He was the only teacher who was, like...
I mean, Mr. Benoit's the one I did the Eminem speech for.
Oh...
You know about that one?
Yeah.
We had a...
Because he does those projects.
Yeah, that's a fun class where at the end, everyone had to do a 2-minute presentation and that was the whole prompt.
Yeah. That was it. Yeah.
And so my whole prompt was a carefully written and rehearsed, like, internal monologue of how I feel the day I have to do a presentation of any kind.
Yeah.
Which was spectacular because I've done some incredibly bad presentations.
Oh.
Like, incredibly bad presentations. And so this one was just about the nerves and, like, from waking up to, like, forgetting things and, like, freaking out and the various time limits in life where you're like, oh, shit, we're here now. Like, oh, shit, the bus is here. Oh, shit, the bus has arrived. Or, oh, yeah. Now, like, the bell is rung. Or, oh, I've been called. And, like, that kind of shit.
Yeah.
And with little dumb, like, narrative flares, like, trying to calm down with music and it being the 8 Mile song from Eminem. Where it's about him being all nervous before a show.
Yeah.
So it gave me a chance to quote that, like, do that song on, to quote a few lines of that song during the presentation, which got everyone laughing. I'm like, am I a fucking performer or something? What the fuck is happening?
And now he's doing YouTube.
It was funny because I'm so nervous and shitty in front of people in general that personifying that and using that for a performance was, like, really effective.
Yeah.
I had handshaking that wasn't an act.
you're doing, like, a performance art, but the performance art is you.
Yeah.
But you're the one performing the performance art of yourself.
It's autobiographical, like, yeah. It's autobiographical of the last few hours.
As he literally sat there trying to write this project.
It was a good comeback because that class was when I did my worst presentation I've ever done.
Oh.
Yeah.
For which...
All right, so this is basically one of my most embarrassing stories.
Oh.
And I don't know if I've ever told you it in general.
And this is Benoit's class?
I think it was, yeah.
Fantastic.
It's one of the most embarrassing stories I've ever had, basically. And the reason for that is because it reflects poorly on me.
Okay.
Specifically.
It's interesting. It's the most embarrassing. Like, I have so many embarrassing, like...
No, not the 2-minute thing.
No, I know.
The bad presentation.
Yeah, the bad presentation. I'm saying that's impressive that a bad presentation
is cool. It's embarrassing because it's not like, oh man, my pants fell down or some other shit like that. It's like, oh man, I'm a bad person. Yeah. Let's just dig into this right now
on this podcast about
how Keith's a bad person when he was 12 years younger and a different person. Literally on a biological level, everything's been replaced.
Yeah.
Probably for the better since then.
I was...
It's actually a learning lesson, a little bit, about how introverted nerds create their own problems.
Okay.
And on some level, their woe is me attitude about how everyone's against them or not being around, wanting to be around people is somewhat a self-imposed penalty that also makes them a shittier person. Which is a lesson that some forms of media try to get across, and a lot of the last, like, 5 years of video game culture has been getting across, but...
I was gonna say, you've been touching on a lot of topics.
This is my dark chapter of being the shittiest nerd of my life, essentially.
Okay.
And not nearly as dark as some of the other examples you can think of, but I'm not proud of it. It's pretty standard shit. You get a book, and you have to do a book report presentation thing.
Okay.
normal shit.
Yeah.
Everyone got a different one. And being insane people that we are, we volunteered to go first, because if we went first, you'd get extra credit because, you know, there weren't other examples to go by yet.
Yeah.
So the sooner you do it, the more extra credit you get, basically.
Yeah.
We had the Scarlet Letter.
Did you pick that, or was it assigned to you?
I don't remember.
Okay.
Honestly. Several mistakes already being made here. First of all, it was me and a nerdy friend of mine that would later become a valedictorian. And then two other people that we don't know.
Okay.
Class.
Perfect.
So it's like, oh. So it's... the two nerd friends and then people they don't either don't know or don't like. Or probably at the time, I probably thought they specifically didn't like me because I probably thought everyone didn't like me back then because it was high school.
Huh.
And I was just in the... Ever since middle school, I was used to the idea of like of people picking on me for one reason or another. And so I had like an antagonistic attitude towards everyone in school besides my friend circle, basically.
It's such the opposite of me where
I'm pretty sure I just totally assumed these people already didn't like me.
I knew people didn't like me because I was specifically a piece of shit to those people.
Oh no.
So I knew they didn't like me, but like that you didn't think people liked you, but you had no interaction with
people.
The
real thing is I had this idea of persecution from people that honestly just didn't think about me.
Yeah.
Which is what a lot of people in the nerd persuasion do to themselves all the time.
Oh yeah.
Essentially. As like I got picked on a few times in like sixth grade and just stuck with it. Essentially. It's like I guess this is the norm now. Yeah. Even though I'm like at the point I'm a junior in fucking high school. And it's like, dude, man,
trauma runs deep.
Yeah, I hate it's why I'm like, and like no one could have fixed that. Like no one could have fixed that in me. So it speaks to our previous podcast about talking about teenagers just being shitty in ways that are both to themselves and others, and you just have to you kind of have to wait out some of it.
Yeah,
because it's not even just the life experience thing, but also like their biological preparation for even dealing with shit. And it's like I was a dumb shit and I had to wait to stop being a dumb shit.
Yeah, your brain makes up problems sometimes, and the solution is for your brain to figure out it made up a problem.
So yeah. Big scary part about this prompt is that the entire class period is yours.
The whole class period?
Yes.
You have to give a presentation for 30 minutes?
Which is terrifying.
That's a long presentation.
And also
free day for the teacher.
Yes, exactly. Benoit loved free days. after seeing other people's presentations later, I would come to realize that like it really didn't seem like you had to go the whole class period at all.
No.
And he would just kind of go with it. And it's like, that seems like a faulty prompt to me. But whatever. I was running with the assumption that was true. So two big problems. Three, aside from that, two big problems. One, I didn't talk to the other two people a single time.
How literally every group project goes with strangers.
Two, I didn't read the book.
You're a terrible person.
Three, I'm terrified of being on stage in front of people, so I did it as machinima.
Wait. It is a machinima that two other people weren't associated with? About a book you didn't read.
A bad machinima.
Well, of course it's going to be bad. You made it in, machinima. Like, what, 2005?
So this is going to start sounding like some kind of Always Sunny episode where it just keeps snowballing. Because the number of mistakes keep compounding upon themselves forever.
Fantastic.
One of which is, I never talked to the two people, and that wasn't their fault.
No.
I just refused to deal with
them. Yeah.
Because I didn't, like, and there was no real, it was just, I was just being pointless, basically. So me and the other guy, we're going off to not read Scarlet Letter because neither of us read it. We were going off of online resource summaries and shit like that to just fake our entire project.
Not a bad idea.
To be fair, I tried reading Scarlet Letter for about 5 minutes and I was like, fuck the way they wrote this. Because it's old.
That's what I was asking. Like,
It's some of that old English shit where it's just like, why is it written like this? I get the story translated?
That's why I was asking, like, was it assigned to you or like, because that's not a book I would
it's
imagine.
It's not a pleasant one, no.
No, it's not a book I'd imagine you would want to personally do a report
I can almost
on.
See that I might have picked it based on just the name because it sounds like a cool name.
Sounds like an RPG.
I don't think I knew anything about The Scarlet Letter.
Oh.
Like, I didn't know it was about.
This was before the movie came out, kids.
Because, by the way, when you go through all the shit about The Scarlet Letter, what, you mean Easy A?
Yeah.
I was like, there's not been a high-profile Scarlet Letter movie. You're literally talking about the Lindsay... Emma Stone.
Yeah, Emma Stone.
Fucking Easy A.
It's literally... What? It's literally the only time people would, like, mate or the average person would have ever heard
I mean, that is a Scarlet Letter adaptation, isn't it, ultimately?
Yes, it is.
It's just a really strange one.
It's Life is Strange levels of, like,
it's the idea of how, like, Life is Strange is Catcher in the Rye. Like, Easy A was Scarlet Letter, down to it being a red A and everything, which was really on the
nose. And she only did that because
that
she read...
on the nose as Roseanne or Roxanne or whatever, being based on Cyrano de Bergerac. Bam, nose jokes, literary nose jokes.
Great.
Only here on Sad Sit and Discuss. Shut up. So we write up a script that's basically regurgitated ideas from us reading several different summaries and then summarizing those summaries, essentially.
He did the machinima for Easy A before the movie came out.
kind of. So at the time, I was into World of Warcraft.
Yes.
And I had WoW Model Viewer.
Mm-hmm. Which is the best way to do machinima.
I'd always use that to make people's thumbnails and stuff like signatures on our guild forum and stuff like that. You could look at every model in the game. And you could even make characters, like in the character customizer for WoW. And you could toggle the different settings for what they look like. You could even make them do all the animations.
I was going to say, it's basically just Gmod. It's like Gary's Mod before Gary's Mod existed.
It's Gary's
more or
Mod,
less.
Except there's no environment.
There's no environment, but like you just get the models and you can put them in any
it's
position
literally
you
a
want.
Just a model viewer,
yeah.
And you can do you can't pose them. You could just play every animation.
Oh, okay.
And you can manually zoom in and out and rotate them.
And you can pause the animation,
yeah,
like mid animation,
yeah,
so you can get a pose that you like.
You can manually drag through the animation and stuff like that. But it was just a model and animation viewer, including all the specializations of like vroom, ice vortexes and shit that are in the game and stuff like that. So we had this a human character that was going to say the lines and shit like that. And nowadays I could do so much better with this because I'm thinking about how like you could like. You could set the back as being a screensaver, being a green screen, which means that you could like
put any background you wanted.
Yeah,
in there.
What do you call it? You can key code out, whatever it's called when you
chroma
code,
key.
You can chroma key it out, and you could like actually do everything right. No, we had the talking animation that humans do with like bap 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 bap.
Yeah,
and that was looping basically. While just our voices were playing as we were just reading the script.
Great.
So it's just a terrible, terrible video.
Yeah.
Just utter garbage. But I was so freaked out about the whole, like, the sheer amount of time they were expecting us to use.
Yeah.
That I came up with an idea of an intermission. So I just literally put in Best Laid Plans for Red vs. Blue. Late episode. So I was like, I'll just air an episode of Red vs. Blue with no context. It's my favorite one. It's totally funny, right? So I just aired that in the middle of the presentation about Scarlet Letter because I'm like, how the fuck do we take up like a 50-minute class with a talk of the Scarlet Letter of all things? And by the way,
this is like a poster. This is like a poster of
this is my shame.
How to be a nerd.
This is all my shame
in high school.
Juxtaposing this with you speedrunning college is going to be the funniest, weird, like paradigm shift on the audience perception of both of us in some ways. So I literally was airing Best Laid Plans in the middle of this book.
I'm sure Benoit was stoked about that. trying to find the relevance at all. Like, what the fuck does that have to do with
which by the way, Scarlet Letter's a shitty book,
yeah,
because like its moral is it doesn't translate, like
it's shit moral.
So like here's the thing, there are other books in that era that are about outdated problems that don't exist in the same way in society, but they can be translated to other elements of society in certain ways.
Yeah,
like Huckleberry Finn deals with all this racism, and it doesn't have literal slavery anymore. Is like not a thing that's as relevant anymore, but it has a bunch of issues that can still translate into today. Or the go-to obvious one is The Crucible, a book about witch trials, which even when it was written was not about witch trials, but was actually an analog for McCarthyism and will literally always be relevant, basically.
More or less.
Because it was always an allegory. it's whoops, old allegory. But the Scarlet Letter sucks.
Yeah.
It's irrelevant and stupid and boring, and its lesson is nothing, kind of. except just to be an archaic look at a really outdated reason to be mad at someone. It's like, oh man, that she sure was an adulterer. That's the whole book.
It's more or less just like it's like a book written out of it's a book about I don't know like what the best way to describe it besides it's a spiteful rendition of how to dislike somebody.
Yeah,
the whole book is just about disliking.
On top of the
person.
Presentation being bad, it's about a book that's also boring as fuck, and no one should care. And well, now imagine that being two nerds just awkwardly narrating this into a microphone as like an animation plays over and over again on the screen of just a guy standing in the middle of a white
probably
background.
A great microphone too.
It was fantastic. It was probably
it was probably
the Rock Band microphone because I definitely had Rock Band by then.
Yeah, I'm just trying to like
I think that's the release year of Rock Band. But no, this just keeps getting worse, by the way. This keeps getting worse.
You can hear the audio. Like, sounds like the first time we recorded.
It's so bad, because... We haven't gotten to the part... We haven't gotten to the day of.
Yeah, I was going to say, what happened
on the day of, new bad things happened.
Oh.
All new bad things happened the day that the actual presentation happened. I couldn't get the video to export. So, that means I couldn't figure out how to get it off my computer. So it was stuck in that. I think it was Windows Media Player or Windows Movie Maker.
Yeah.
I don't think I'd even heard of Vegas and Premiere yet.
No.
That's around the time I heard of Vegas for the first time because every Machinima person on wowmachinima.com or whatever it was called.
Yeah.
Like their credits always said like Sony Vegas version 6 or something like that.
Because it had chroma key.
Yeah. Like everyone was using WoW Model Viewer in Vegas. So that's why I knew about WoW Model Viewer in the first place. So I couldn't get it to export, and so I needed to bring my computer to school
on the bus
in a suitcase. Yeah, I think I put it in the under compartment on the bus and had to get it out and everything. And my dad was furious with the idea of me taking my computer because he thought it was going to be stolen and stuff like that, which is not an unreasonable thing, I guess.
It's not unreasonable, but where are they going to go with it?
I don't know, but I was putting it in a suitcase like the ones you use to travel.
Yeah.
And so I was just in that without context of what was inside.
Had a suitcase.
Yeah. Like a rolling suitcase.
Okay.
Like I put that with my computer tower and monitor and stuff like that. And put
with
I think there was a monitor.
There's no way. You put a CRT monitor inside of a suitcase?
They probably weren't flat yet, huh? I must have found a monitor on campus when I was there.
You probably just used Benoit's computer.
Probably.
Just unhooked his computer.
I think I brought my tower and plugged it into his
computer. Okay, I was going to say, there's no way you brought a CRT to... Like, I can't imagine you like...
No. Because back then they were huge.
Yeah.
No, but I brought my whole tower there. I had to open it up in Windows Movie Maker, and I had to play it on like the timeline in order to play it. Because I couldn't export it.
Yeah.
So I had to play it in the video editor, basically. And I couldn't... Benoit had those shitty little beige speaker towers that have no range or volume.
Nope.
So a class of 30 people's crowding into one corner of the room around one tiny screen because we couldn't get to like projector. We don't have projectors back then. We just had the the transparency thing.
I thought he didn't have a projector.
No, we just had all we had was the one for slides. All we had was those projectors where you sit up in the middle of the room and it would shoot a light through a mirror, basically, onto the wall. And you'd write with a dry erase or whatever the fuck.
Sharpies. 70 kids will get.
Being in school in the 2000s is like being in the 70s.
it was a weird time before, like, technology
All of our books were from the 70s and smelled like 70s kids, remember?
It was during a dark time before, like... technology really boomed, so then everything was like digital era.
So as you might imagine, I feel horrible the entire presentation, but also the moment the intermission comes and no one's reacting to it, I have that moment of like charging to the forward of the class to skip past because I'm realizing this does not work.
Yeah,
this is not universal humor. This is not a reasonable intermission. Everyone's like, what the fuck is happening?
Yes.
So that's one of the more crippling emotional moments of my history. But
Keith got to experience searching something up on YouTube and showing it to somebody and them not being excited for it.
So this isn't the part I'm embarrassed about yet.
Oh, no, I imagine not.
No, we're not there yet. No, it's the shitty way I reacted to all of this afterwards that makes it worse. Because up until now, these are innocent mistakes.
Okay, yeah. They're just...
The worst part I've done so far is not work with the other students, which just happens all the time anyway.
How did they... They just showed up and were like...
It was weird how they didn't press the issue at any point. They seemed weirdly content to let me do it. Although I think I might have found out later on that one of them had a death in the family around that time. And so that might have been why they were weirdly not involved or even asking about it. But that doesn't excuse the other person really at all.
Sure does.
No, they're not related to each other in any way.
They were the one who died.
Wow, it was a weird retcon of my own memory there. Until then, this is just a series of dumb mistakes of somebody trying to do something both lazy and weirdly ambitious at the same time.
Yeah, it's weirdly creative, but also very lazy.
So creative and lazy. Like, I'm undershooting it, but also having really inventive ways of trying to get around the fact that I just didn't want to be doing a presentation in front of class.
You didn't want to speak to them personally.
Yeah, the entire goal here was to make a video so I didn't have to be in front of the class.
Yeah.
That's the transparent fact of the situation. Which, by the way, will come to technical problems later, because it affected another thing that same year. Mm. But in a less embarrassing way. No, what happens, we get our grades back, and first of all, I threw them under the bus immediately.
Who, the other two?
Yes. So I outed the fact that they didn't have any hand on the project at all, and,
What led to this, like, explosion of disgust with the class?
Well, I had the reaction of, like, how bad it was going, and I knew it was bad, so I told the teacher that only two of us actually did the project.
Oh. So you're telling this to Benoit.
I'm not like, I'm not like going out in front of everyone.
Oh, okay.
Not yet. Foreshadowing.
Good.
Fuck, I hate the story. I've been hiding it for so long. But now it's so far ago, it literally doesn't feel like me.
Yeah.
This does not feel like my own history.
Trust me,
it's so long ago, it literally feels like a different person all did this, and I'm talking shit about somebody else.
Yeah. If I talked about my past, it would be the same way.
I cannot relate to any of these decisions.
Yeah.
Except for the part about trying to not do a presentation. I can super relate to that one. That's why I don't have face cam.
How do you ever get through these podcasts?
There's the immediate throwing under the bus part.
Yes. To the teacher.
So Benoit's response to that was to give my friend and I an 82 and the other two people a 75. Wow, what a big deal, right? Everyone got a passing grade. We can all move on to this. We could just ignore this, forget this all ever happened. Boy, did I not do that. Instead, we had a mailing system for the class.
A mailing system?
Yeah, like an email system.
Yeah?
Which I thought... All right, so what I do is I type this big... an essay to Benoit about this issue, basically being mad that I didn't get an A just for doing it first, essentially, because of the extra credit elements or whatnot. And I talk shit about the 7-point difference between the people who did the entire project and the people that did none of the project. I even titled the entire thing Unlucky Number 7, like some pretentious asshole. Not even joking. And it was like a page-long rant thing.
How do high school teachers like exist?
Yeah, they have to put up with these people. The people, the exact kind of person our whole last podcast was about, who I was. I the most pretentious, complainy, fucking annoying, like, I want to see your manager ass email. I had a gross misunderstanding of how the email system worked, so it went to the entire class.
Yes.
Perfect. So it went directly to everyone, including the people that I was talking about, and my partner, and several other people, and Benoit, everyone.
How much longer did you have in this class?
Because it was literally the only message I ever sent. We were probably like halfway through.
Ooh, boy!
Because we were the first book report of the entire semester.
100% perfect. So you have the remainder of this semester to deal with everyone knowing this incident. Like,
yeah.
This incident is like very... very fresh, and it will be that way for the entire semester.
Never came up again. Not explicitly.
I mean, no.
But it probably didn't help me in a number of ways.
No, probably not.
So many weird things would happen. Between this and another thing, I think it might be the reason why a rumor started happening about me, which was a weird thing in its own right.
You had rumors about
you?
Yeah,
that was
cool.
That was a weird feeling.
I never got rumors about me.
Maybe you did. Maybe they just didn't reach you, because this one reached me out of nowhere, and I was and it was late in school when it reached me.
It's probably true.
So that was that whole chapter.
Okay.
It kind of self-explanatory why it feels the way it does for so many reasons, and why it reflects so poorly on me.
That's quite
as being just the shittiest person all around.
Quite a catastrophe.
It might be the worst thing I've ever done.
That's impressive, because I would consider that on like a scale of like 1 to 10. That's probably like a 5 on how bad you could be as a person scale.
Well, obviously,
yeah.
I know you can be way worse, but I don't.
No, I mean like as in
you
I'm just
probably have.
I'm comparing it to what I did in high school. That's a pretty 5.
What you did last podcast?
What did I do last podcast?
I think being in cheating triangles is probably worse than
mean
emails.
Look, I've got a suit. I can cheat.
That's not a suit. That's a button-up shirt.
Well, I have the... do you want me to go get the damn jacket?
No. You're going to hit the microphone. But between that and another thing, I would always judge things wrong. So we were in a debate in that same class.
Okay.
We got topics, and we were just given sides of the topic to debate.
Yeah.
Standard shit.
Usually how a debate works.
I was paired with the same person again.
And, your friend?
Yeah.
This is a mistake.
The same class. We were given dress code, and we were supposed to be pro dress code.
Pro dress code.
So at one point during said debate, I commented on how somebody on the other team was dressed.
That's a fair argument.
Because she was wearing like a tank top.
Like, that's not even part of school policy. Like, no, school policy says you're not supposed to have sleeveless shirts.
Yeah, she was wearing basically like a wife beater, basically. Like, all she was wearing, like where it's like her bra straps are visible, and she's wearing the wife beater looking
thing.
That
is against school policy.
And that's that. And so I comment on that as part of the thing, as like evocative clothes. I'm like, I don't care about...
No.
Like, I don't give a shit about the thing. I'm literally just arguing the point that I was given, because we draw them out of a hat.
Yep.
I don't give a shit about school uniforms. But because of that, I'm sure it didn't help.
No.
Because that there was a reaction to that comment, and I was like, what? Did I do that wrong? There was like a moment of like, what happened? Because that was junior year. Very end of senior year, I found out that apparently everyone in school thought I was gay. Like, it was somehow like a weird circulated rumor that I'd never reached me a single time until like 3 separate people, because one person revealed it, and then several other people that I talked to like corroborated that. And I was like, how did I get a rumor? Because literally all of college, all of high school.
Really weird rumor to.
Because my high school situation was like yours.
Okay.
Where like,
well, we went to the same high school.
I mean like the way you treated like free time and everything.
Oh yeah.
Just sitting in one spot with the same group of friends like every day, basically.
Yes.
Like that's how like I was involved in no group things or extracurriculars or other stuff going on and stuff like that. Like I was just with a few people every time. I'm like, how would like, do people just get bored?
Yes.
I think like I all I could think of was like either generated from nothing or generated from the. Like what I said about how a girl was dressed once.
Yeah.
Even though that wasn't an artificial situation.
I mean, it depends on how you presented it. Like if you
like fuck context. You
know, like if you presented it very flamboyantly, like girl, that is not a flattering top. Let me tell you a better top.
I was a character, which I thought people understood as a concept, but I guess not.
Oh, maybe
I don't
know.
Maybe that didn't go well. These are 4 presentations that all happen the same year.
That's impressive.
Fuck.
I had the same. Because
there's the 2-minute M&M one. There's the debate one where it's two groups of two debating in front of middle of like a circle of people. There was the one where the horrible thing happened. And then there was my German presentation.
Okay.
My Deutsche Zombie was it Deutsche Zombie Spielshow or something like that. We were making a trivia game show.
Oh, okay.
It's one of the most fun I've ever had in any project ever.
Oh, that's a good, positive story now.
Yeah, there's just technical problems at the end of it.
Oh.
But...
what were the technical problems?
The entire thing came out at like 4 frames per second.
Oh, the video.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh.
Because what happened is I was recording on a camcorder and we shot everything. And it was great. We had fun. Then I realized the camcorder is like recording to tape. I'm like, how the fuck do I edit a tape? And I'm like, what's a firewire? Like, all this other shit's happening. Ah! I don't know what steps happened, but eventually I was able to get some version of it onto a computer to edit and everything, but it was at like 4 frames per second, and I don't know. Like,
you probably use
one
of those.
I was so not ready to deal with that.
I bet you use one of those magic things
maybe.
Where you plug the yellow and red into it.
It was some generic-ass camcorder, and it's like, nowadays I could magic a problem out of it because I have all these ways of taking video inputs and recording them.
Yes,
that's how my job works.
Yeah,
but back then I was unprepared as a junior. But
most cameras thankfully come with SD card slots now, so it makes the process easy.
But what I did is I got one of my mom's jackets that has like the shoulder pads and shit.
Okay.
Because it looks like that's my idea apparently of a game show host is like weird shoulder pads.
They have the padded shoulders.
And I had like hairspray and shit going on. And I was the host of the German game show.
Okay.
And we were just at it. We were asking insultingly elementary questions to all the contestants, which were the other people in my group from the class. It was like six people, really nice, healthy group sizes for dumb projects.
Yeah.
Just have like six people. I would ask them the question in German and they would respond in German because the whole show is just in German.
Just made a German.
But they were really
show.
Dumb questions like the what's your favorite color, like Holy Grail question and stuff like that.
Yeah.
It was that kind of shit.
Yeah.
And if anyone got an answer wrong, they would be dragged away by my friend Ryan dressed as a zombie, and he'd just be roaring and sobbing and like acting weird, and he had his shirt pulled over his head because it made his silhouette weird, because that's all, we didn't have cosmetics. It was just like we put a little makeup on his face and then pulled his shirt over his head so that his like have a hunchback weird pose, and he just dragged people down the hallway and around the corner because we had like a nice tile floor where it was just smooth. You've seen that hallway.
Yeah.
It's the one
you just did in your house. Yeah.
So they drag them like down the corner around the banister, and it was not the whole, like there was actually like some directorial like comedy here that I'm proud of, because it was this dumb jovial thing where I'm being all like cloy and fun and shit like that, and the game show's fun and silly, and the zombie scenes are not fun. They're screaming and it's horrible as much as it can be with no special effects of any kind.
Yeah.
Like they're literally like, it's Ryan dragging women down a hallway as they are just screaming and grabbing onto banisters and shit like that, and it looks desperate and horrible, and then it just cuts right back to me asking like a dumb question like, ha. Yes, very good, and stuff like that. Like, it's like, and all this dumb shit is happening. I have it, by the way. We can literally watch this. I think I have it on Facebook still.
Really?
Yeah.
Is it 4 frames per second?
Yeah.
Oh, God damn it! Come on.
I don't even have the originals. Which also, the originals are on a tape on a camcorder that I don't think isn't around anymore. Oh, what if I could find that camcorder and what if the tape still exists? She probably taped over it. My mom probably taped over it since then, if she even has the camcorder anymore.
She might. It's worth checking.
That'd be a piece of history.
Yeah. And you can get it off there now without...
It might even be on my YouTube channel unlisted somewhere. But yeah, just every single time, like, I would ask a dumb question, and they'd sometimes get it right, sometimes get it wrong. There was a big dumb scoreboard for points or whatever the fuck. That was all... It's all scripted anyway, so who cares? But, like... We literally rip off the Holy Grail at one point by having someone get their, like, second guessing their own favorite color for a second and then getting zombied for answering wrong at first. Like that kind of stuff.
For answering their favorite color wrong?
Yeah. It was the whole, I was intentionally doing the whole thing as a joke because of how, ever since first year of German class, one moment was always so funny, which is that my teacher said, V. Gates, which is just, how are you? And somebody answered, Choco Shake. So it's like, how you doing? Chocolate shake. And I'm like, we've been here for a year and you can't answer the question. I'm like, Friedrich, what's wrong with you? You can't answer the fucking question we learned in the first day. What's wrong with you? And he wasn't joking. He just was stupid.
Oh, he's just genuinely not understanding.
Yeah, it's part of our last day in our German class. My teacher just asked every single person a question.
Yeah.
In German, and they'd answer, and it wasn't even like graded, it was just like an exercise, because, you know,
just saying like goodbye time.
Yeah, you know? And it's just, how's it going, chocolate shake? I'm like, I like
Lamb just seems like the kind of person though that would just be like,
oh, he's the best teacher ever. He's the best teacher I've ever met.
Yeah,
he's fantastic. And he's I got to be his TA.
That's pretty cool.
Because I did 3 years of German, and then the fourth year of German conflicted with my other classes, so I had to do something else with, like, I had a middle-of-the-day period that I was required to have, but there was no class to put in it, and I couldn't take anything for a year, because it was I was only had a conflict in my schedule for one semester. So I'm like, okay, I'll be a TA for Lamb because he's the best teacher ever.
Yeah.
And I was so I'm like making coffee and grading German papers, and I was known as being like this horrible person apparently because I kept like very savagely grading these first year German students as a third year German, and I'm like, well, they're wrong.
Great.
I think he just put a curve on the class whenever I was grading it or something to make up for that. But I'm like, he just told me to grade the
papers.
Yeah,
he just was like, so I was like, you know, if like, they're
wrong,
wrong.
And that's wrong, and that's wrong, and that's wrong. So there's like indirect resentment for me for people I never met.
I'm trying to think. Like, I'm trying to think of the worst thing I did at high school.
Yeah, so it's I'm 50-50 on presentations. There's the two bad ones and the two ones where I'm really happy with.
I know I had two bad debates. Both of them were in history class, both of them for the same history teacher. I don't remember her name. Mm-hmm. But she was very adamant about making very toxic like debates.
Oh god.
One of them was why, basically, she split the class into male and female, mm-hmm. and she said, why is your gender superior to the other?
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
So not even, like, a political topic.
No.
But like, incendiary, horrible topic.
Because we were learning about women's suffrage at the time. And so we were supposed to argue, basically, to decide, like, well, why should women be treated equally to men? And, you know, comparison... And that didn't go well for me personally, because I just got into it where it's
you're
like
you're just poisoning.
Yes,
you're either poisoning the guys to just be wrong, essentially, and like be on the wrong side of history or something and be like just stuck with a doomed debate, or you're poisoning them to make themselves seem like the worst people in school.
Yeah.
For a project.
It turned into a situation where
I'm guessing you were on the pro male side.
Oh yeah,
and you had to deal with that, and you went for it.
It was more of a.
Of course you yeah. would.
Well, okay. So let me put some preference here. So by this point, we had learned about the first instance of like to bring context. At one point, we had learned about.
This is a fun podcast so far.
It is.
First topic, and it's going to be the whole podcast.
We learned about what was it? I think it was Malcolm X. I think it was. We were learning about Malcolm X. Mm-hmm. And at one point, I remember asking the teacher.
Man, pro tip for teachers. When you set up debates between students, maybe don't pick ones that frame some of your students as being racist or sexist.
Yes. Highly recommended.
you can do the whole school uniform debate and be on the wrong side of it or whatever, or the right side. And guess what? You're not a monster.
No. So we were learning about basically the civil rights movement.
Mm-hmm.
During one of the sessions, we were learning about Malcolm X. And mm-hmm. I specifically asked, like, why is this relevant to me? Like, why does this matter at all? This particular event, Malcolm X at all, I don't give a shit. This has nothing to do with anything related to like what actually caused civil rights to matter, which was Martin Luther King, people doing protests and so on. I don't care about some dude getting beat in the street. I don't give a fuck about that. And that didn't go well.
Can't imagine why.
Yeah, I can't imagine why. Yeah, so that didn't go well. A lot of people were not pleased, specifically the teacher who was African-American.
Teenager Andrew is here to white-splain racism.
Yeah. Well, no, I mean, I validated, like, Martin Luther King was important. His whole march is Malcolm X, not important. Literally a waste of space. I don't need him.
I mean, I want to argue with you here, but you were like a 17-year-old, and I don't want to deal with 17-year-old Andrew.
No.
I have trouble with 29-year-old Andrew.
Yeah, 17-year-old Andrew is basically like, it's not relevant to me. I don't care about this person, and we don't have a holiday based on him, so he's not cool.
And I'm glad to see your logic system hasn't changed over the years at all.
Basically. And so, so that basically put me as like, Andrew's a piece of shit. Was like what the class
I literally can't tell sometimes whether you're literally talking about your legit logic system or it's a joke. Your actual logic sounds like it's constructed like a joke in many cases.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I don't know.
That's the beauty of it. That's my favorite.
I can't tell what you are.
That's what I love. That's like
something that like Ricky Gervais would say or some shit. He can't be important. He doesn't have a holiday.
Yeah. I mean, it's true. Martin Luther King got a coin and a holiday. You know what Malcolm X got? Nothing. He got like a thing in the
Rosa
book.
Parks page. Skip it. They don't
no,
have
Rosa
day.
Parks got a coin. She's important. Malcolm X got nothing. He's not important.
There's probably a Malcolm X coin.
No, there
somewhere.
Isn't. I checked. He's not important. No one cares about him.
You checked that no one's ever...
Yes, no one's done anything. Ever. The only thing that people talk about... that's not the point.
There's movies about him.
Of course there's movies. You run out of black people to talk about that are influential at some point.
Oh, God.
I'm not being... I'm not being spiteful about it. I'm saying, literally, there's not... We don't care enough as a society about influential black people, so you run out of the history...
Do you know Kyle Kellengren?
No.
Not a person that we know, but I mean, on the internet, the guy that does he's one of the people that's from the guy with the glasses group overall.
Okay. Yeah.
And he's the one that whenever I link his one of his videos, he's sitting in front of a bookcase and he's talking about a philosophical thing or a Shakespeare movie or something like that.
Okay.
Or he has that one video I really like, which is that it's Washington D.C. always plays itself.
Yeah.
He did a good video about a woman called the Watermelon Woman, I think it's called.
Okay.
And it was about that idea of, there was this woman who was searching through history to find an influential black lesbian woman. A representation of who she was in history.
Yeah.
Anywhere.
Just
and how hard that is.
Yeah.
To even find a single person like yourself remembered by history. And she's basically, stalking through time this one person that was in this one that had this movie career back in the day and everything like that, and trying to find out what was her real name, what did she do, where'd she live, what was her history, because it's so hard to piece it together.
Yeah.
And the fucking twist at the end of the movie is that the one person that she found to reveal to as a reference to herself that this whole movie's about was fictional. She made her up. She made the whole movie up because there was no person like that. So, yeah, I get what you're talking about literally history just ignoring people that are important, but they're through the filter of people that would be ignored.
Yeah.
In history.
And
that's a movie about someone who literally can't find an example of herself existing.
Yeah. And that's the point I'm saying is I wasn't trying to say black people aren't important. I'm saying we just, except for just him.
Just
he's not important. Fuck that guy. Everyone else is important. Not him. I swear. Fuck that guy. God, I hate that shit.
Oh,
I hate
man.
That entire thing. But the class thought I was a piece of shit, and rightfully so. And so when it came down to
it's usually true,
yeah. And so when it came down to debating, we also had another one which wasn't really important, which was she also broke us apart between the African American students and the white students and to argue against each other.
Oh boy.
This is not a great teacher.
That's not a great... These are not good actions.
This
it's like she's trying to recreate the previous decade's, conflicts.
She's trying to start problems.
Let's just bring them back.
My argument was...
The closest thing I ever had to this was in college. I took magic, witchcraft, and religion, and we did a witch trial in class.
That sounds fun.
Yeah. Because no one thinks anyone's a witch.
Yeah. Yeah, really.
And we did the same. It was exactly like the Crucible, where whenever anyone would argue against you, you would just say that they were a witch too.
I saw a comic.
And by the end, 10 people were dead.
I think I saw a comic the other day where so
I had a hell of a KD in that room.
A lot of witches today. Yeah. the black versus white one didn't go well. There's not really much to talk about except for my I think my argument against why, I think the entire point was why should slavery not be, why should slavery be overturned or not overturned from the perspective of a black person or a white person?
Don't do that to your kids.
And so, yeah. And
don't do that to your nearly adult kids.
Yeah.
Where everything they say affects whether or not they can be president one day.
I cannot.
You once said that black people should be slaves forever.
I wasn't
in an artificial situation that this one person put me into as a role play.
Yeah.
It's we have you on tape because everything's on tape now. Everyone has cell phones.
Thankfully they didn't.
And that footage survives.
I no one had cell phones at that time. God. I was generous. I did not say that they deserve to be slaves. I did say that if they no longer wish to work for us, then the contract is over and we will send you back home. That would be the description, that you're not allowed to live in America because America is your workplace. It's not your home.
Like a green card argument of sorts?
Basically, I said, we're deporting them then. We kick all the African Americans back to Africa, where they belong, because that's their home. They don't. They go. They come here
it's
to work.
Both horrible and oddly creative.
Yeah, and I was looked at as like a monster. They're like, well, they worked here, but they're not citizens, so they don't live here. They're workers. They go home when they're done. It was like they just don't have an. They just don't actually have a time when they're supposed to end because slavery's forever. Like, we just didn't give them an end to the contract, but they want one, so they go home now.
I mean, in many ways, as horrible as it is, it's an improvement over the actual options they had.
Well, yeah, I didn't say, like, kill them, or, like, you know...
Because that's... I'm sure a lot of them would have taken that option if they actually could at the
time. I wasn't unreasonable. I said, you can send them home. You don't have to kill them. You can give them...
Except that would never happen.
No. Well, no.
Sending them home would be like a meat grinder around back. It'd be like when you hear about your pets going to the farm, or whatever.
Yeah,
like they're gonna charter a separate ship to Africa for every time a slave wants to leave. Like, totally be a lie.
I meant more of like,
that's the horrible thing.
I meant more of like, we're doing this in one go. Like, if slavery
is
like
one group.
Yeah, like if slavery's done,
this is your singular get out of jail free card from slavery.
Yes, basically it's like, if you don't want to be a slave, you speak up now. We put all of you, it doesn't matter how many of you are, all of you on a boat, whether it sinks or swims, and you're going back to Africa. It's your boat now. You go where you want. We're not bringing you there. We're just giving you
Could
a boat.
They just land on the other side of the United States and be like, this is our state.
No,
now.
The moment my argument, because that was what someone was like, yeah, someone
can
did specifically.
Can they just go to one of the parts of the United States that they didn't have yet?
Yeah,
just
someone
like,
was
this
like,
one's ours.
What if they go somewhere? And I said, look, the moment
it's just
they.
A very different backstory for Oregon.
for one, when slavery was around, I mean, this is during the revolution, more or less. Yeah. So we had all this. We had all the coastal states.
Hey, did we go all the way from one side to the other by then?
Yeah, we already had California.
Not even that, but like, did we have everything in between already?
For the most part, yeah. Yeah, we had everything in between.
Did we already have like 48 states by the time the revolution happened?
I think we didn't. The only ones I don't think we had was Hawaii and...
That's why it's 48.
I think we had Alaska. Did we have... No, we didn't have Alaska either. So yeah, it was... Yeah, we had the 48 states.
We had the contiguous.
Yeah.
Plus or minus maybe whether or not certain things had become North and South yet or not.
We had North America minus Canada.
Hmm.
Basically.
Do you think you ever feel like any insecurity over like there's nice even splits sometimes that are like agreed upon, like a nice happy divorce.
Yeah.
Where it's like North Dakota, South Dakota, and then like other ones are like, it's Virginia and West Virginia. You have like the shitty tumor of Virginia.
Yeah.
It's like we're defined as being next to the real one. Like, you don't have California and not California.
Yeah.
Like, that's not...
Well, that's kind of what Oregon is.
I mean, I said it's like an amicable divorce. I'm pretty sure that Dakota was split by the Revolutionary War.
It was, yes.
So obviously not, but I'd just be like, this...
Yeah.
It's like, it's so weird that we have like North and South Korea, North and South Dakota, and like just West Virginia. It's not East Virginia. It's just, it's real Virginia.
There's Virginia and then West
There's
Virginia.
The real Virginia.
Yeah. But anyway, so we had that debate. That didn't matter.
I guess the thing, there might have been rumors about you too in high school.
Probably. So with the male and female,
you're telling me this shit happened.
The male and female thing got a lot worse. That did not do favors for me. For any gender,
they put you on the bad side of both.
No,
I guess you are a white male.
Yeah, I'm a white male, so I got on the bad side on both of these situations because prejudice.
Holy
shit, that's my racism.
Your teacher was doing what people only think hypothetical people do on the internet.
Yes,
like everyone's mad at people on the internet for this idea that never actually seems to ever happen to them.
I'll be
but
honest,
this was happening to you in real life in person.
unfortunately. And so by the time the male and female one rolled around, everyone was pretty much convinced like, Andrew will do it. He'll be able to come up with a good argument. And my argument was like, women historically are so pathetically easy to destroy. it is incredibly easy to rape them. It is incredibly easy to enslave them. It is incredibly easy to force them to do what you want. Women are just nothing. They are nothing without men. It is incredibly easy to just destroy them as an entire gender, if not for men. They even need to only, like, basically the only purpose that they served for the longest time.
The deepest possible.
I just
hole.
I was like, forget it. I don't care. This is stupid. I'm just gonna go ham.
Oh fuck.
And at that point, the
what's
most
horrible is that this is literally the arguments that are really happening.
Yeah.
So it's what your teacher should expect you to say if you're going to even try.
Yeah.
Is to say what people actually do say when it comes to gender stuff.
I don't think the rape thing was. I don't think they were ready for that.
No, that was like, we're so good at raping women is usually not the argument they make. No, but like how, like the weakness of women is literally the go-to argument when you talk about gender differences, especially if you're on the shitty side of it, and they put you there.
Yeah.
And the script is already written at some point.
Yeah, it's already done.
And it's like, you're just dooming your kids. Like, this seems like an unethical thing to do in class.
I don't think she works there anymore. I just remember specifically all the girls going, no. that's just like their only response. Like, no. I will say that the teacher, I will say that she probably.
He just the most cartoonish argument of like being like, your dog is easy to kill. I'm just like,
pathetic.
He just went straight for it. And I'm like, what the
fuck? I mean, what else am I going to say? There's not a real argument I can make, which is like the most annoying part of that entire endeavor is that like.
Your options are be cartoonishly evil or be really insidiously evil.
Yeah.
like doing the kind of shit that people do where they're like justifying their racism by looking at like the skull of an African American or whatever. And like
the only thing I could think of that would be
to be like, I'm gonna tie Rocky and Bullwinkle to the train tracks, or to be like Candy from like Candy's Ranch and Django.
Yeah.
Like that's your only other option, is to be like that type of evil.
Yeah. Like it's either cartoon
or to just throw the debate, which is probably what a lot of people should do when forced into that unethical situation.
My options were either be cartoonish, or my secondary option was like, if need be, I would go into genetics and how they're pathetic genetically, which is like women are programmed to be biologically in need of males so that they can procreate, because that's our only literal function in society.
And this is what you're trapped with.
Yeah. And so I was like, I'm just gonna go with cartoon, because what's the worst that can happen? The worst did come to happen. That was not that did not go, because basically everyone else that wasn't me in that class.
Did you have any meetings with people outside of the class as a result of that?
No.
By which I mean not the students, I mean like officials at the school.
No, I didn't.
I had to fucking deal with people for drawing clouds once.
Drawing clouds?
They thought I was emotionally unstable because I was drawing dark clouds and stuff like that in my drawings as a young child.
What? Really?
But it was because I saw Wizard of Oz and I wanted it to rain.
I just
thought storms were cool. I didn't have the context of like, this means you're sad.
In that same class, I think I specifically remember one of the reasons, the only time I ever had the teacher talk to me was, she had us give a presentation during World War II about what was a thing that.
And in that one, she made you argue in favor of the Nazis just to continue the trend.
No, we didn't have to do a debate like that.
It sure seemed to be what her life goal was.
Yeah,
was just to ruin you.
No, she her,
stage by the, stage.
The project was like find a piece of World War II history that's something you're passionate about. Like,
surprised
what was,
she didn't make you do a speech on why hope is wrong.
I don't know. But our project for that was for World War II was basically to give a presentation on what was a thing in World War II that we that was interesting, or that people should know about, or that, you know, you liked a lot. And so, you know, most people were like, here's a platoon that did something really impressive, here's a battle that was really impressive. I was like, here is the Panzer tank. And this is why it's the most impressive thing ever. It's because not only was it destructive, but it was the purest form of why Nazi technology was going to be amazing if they won the war. And it was like, because it had, and I explained, like, flamethrowers on the front of a tank is ingenious.
Wasn't that the tank that was virtually indestructible unless you flanked it?
Yes.
Like, you had to actually get behind it.
You had to literally get behind it, and you can only shoot it with another
tank. That's always a plot point that happens in, like, in Fury, the movie, and then, like, a bunch of World War II video games, and weirdly, a bunch of World War JRPGs.
Yes.
It's like, it's a convenient game mechanic that makes them more interesting to fight, is that you have to flank them to defeat them.
And it's real.
And it was also in Call of Duty 2 was a recurring.
It was also in Panzer Tanks are also in Company Heroes 2.
Yeah.
They have
thing. This mechanic has been reinforced in my brain by so many video games.
Yeah.
Learning about this thing about like Panzers just being really
because
fucking
Panzers
hard to kill.
Panzers are fucking awesome.
Yeah.
But it didn't look good because I'm sitting there like praising German technology.
Yeah. Turns out when you have a horrible like fascist mega military government and the belief that you're right no matter what, that you can just put untold resources towards mega weapons.
Look, I'm just saying, Panzer tank, human ethics. Not really equatable.
No.
Panzer tanks are way more valuable. Because you don't need human ethics.
It's kind of gross how somebody in the same class going on an amazing rant about how amazing this drone is or this super jet that America uses.
Yeah.
Is, and no one would question it.
Yeah.
And that stuff's even worse now.
Oh, yeah.
That stuff's so much worse now.
It only gets
worse. They're literally death machines for killing people.
Yeah.
And that's all they exist for. And praising their construction is like, it has the same creepy tinge, but it's
patriotic.
But it's based on, if it's patriotic, we just turn a blind eye to it.
Yeah.
And now it's cool. And I'm like, it always, like, I was always the person that would, like, feel uncomfortable even at a young age with the Pledge of Allegiance.
Really?
Yeah. Because it's like, this is, it looks like what I've learned about all the evil countries. Like, when I look at our military and I look at our Pledge of Allegiance, so many other things, I'm like, that's what all the evil countries do in all the movies about evil people.
Well, that's literally what every country does.
And all of our, like, propaganda throughout the years about how evil other groups are, paint them, like when I see the Pledge of Allegiance, I'm like, I'm thinking of like North Korea.
Yeah.
Like this weird, like we're like unanimous, impregnable praise for a fictionalized version of ourselves, essentially. And like, and we're always right and we're the best and we don't have to question anything and defeat all others. Is like, what it feels like when you're having a bunch of 7-year-olds pledged to a flag in like a grid, like it's a military formation and shit like that. I'm like, we're just not wearing red and that's why it's cool.
National anthems are
so uncomfortable.
Yeah, national anthems are a really odd thing to do. Like there's like patriotism for your country is literally pointless.
And if you even voice these ideas, you're immediately thrown in the opposite end of the spectrum.
You're like some unpatriotic, like
an America hater or a terrorist or something like that.
I would rather be that than I'm just a Nazi.
Like, but you can't.
Yeah, Nazis.
Yeah, like it's
It's weird.
It's super weird. It's always weird, and you do it to children, which makes it weirder.
As a kid,
so much weirder.
As a kid, I never thought about it, only because
I literally went all of high school not speaking during that.
Yeah, I never said it though.
Yeah,
I always put my hand to my chest, but I just never said it.
Every single day, I sat there and I just was in silence because I'm like, this is uncomfortable. Everyone freaks out if you don't stand up.
Yeah, I didn't. I never said it just because I felt it was unnecessary. Like, why did I need to vocalize that I was an American citizen?
The entire class is already doing it.
Sure. But, like, it was also a thing of, like, why do I have...
Also, the under God part, I'm like, fuck off.
Yeah, that was also another thing. I was like,
as a child, I was like, I'm saying words, don't know what words mean, not thinking about this. No, critical thinking hasn't come yet. Got to pre-order it for later. But high school comes around, and I'm like, I don't go to church. I'm not religious at all.
You know,
I'm like, what the fuck?
You know, can't pull that off in?
Who?
Perry's class. He will fucking end you.
We didn't do the pledge in his class, though, because it was the wrong time of day.
Yeah, you got lucky.
Yeah.
I had him... I did a first period with him once, and that was...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, one person was like, I don't believe in the Pledge of Allegiance. He's like, I don't believe you're a student in my class anymore. And I was like, damn, this person just got kicked out.
Oh, boy.
Because it's an elective class. He can just kick them out of an elective class.
Yeah.
So he just kicked them out. He's like, I will not tolerate
unpatriotism.
Just for
not being pro... Pledge of Allegiance.
He was a military man.
Oh, was he?
Yeah, he was an Air Force pilot.
Oh. Really all I remember about
him. Also, we live next to an Air Force base. You kind of have to be patriotic by default.
That is an ongoing thing. We get to hear, like, Air Force... We, on top of hearing planes all the time, we get to hear, like...
The Pledge of Allegiance literally being played out of the fucking intercom system.
Or, like, the wake-up music.
Yeah.
Stuff like... Grab your brush and put a little makeup.
Isn't the wake-up music like the cavalry?
Bum, 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 bum.
Oh, that one.
Bum, 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 bum. But you hear it from, like, miles away. Yeah. You're like, how loud is that on the bass?
I can hear it from here.
Yes.
And for example, like my home to the base.
I grew
base,
up hearing it every morning.
Yeah, my home
and
to the base
not in
is
the
like
same
a,
we're technically in a different town.
Yeah.
There's noise pollution. We should sue the base.
I thought about that, but you can't because the base isn't part of the city.
Yeah.
So they don't follow. It's like technically you have to sue the federal government, and the federal government doesn't have noise complaint rules against them. So you can't because I thought about that at some point, because I was like, I'm tired of waking up in the morning and I hear the freaking national anthem being played from like a mile. It sounds like someone's doing a cavalry charge from the distance. Like you hear like,
like it's far enough away that you'd have to do like the pyres are lit. Gondor calls for aid. Yeah. Like across several fields to even see there.
Yeah.
Like it's so far away. You'd have to do like signals to even like connect the dots between here and there.
It's basically like a redcoats are coming situation where like I can hear it in the distance and I have to like go warn the town like the redcoats are coming. Like granted, I will say living here is terrifying because the planes for the base are like 100% closer than they should ever be to a human house.
Oh yeah,
like they'll come in hot and you're like, well, don't drop the cargo here.
that's even worse with where I live now. There's
really
a, yeah, there's a strip right there to the point where like you drive down the road towards my area and like the bigger road, and you'll just see a plane directly overhead close enough to where it's like, oh, that's how big they are. Like when they're no longer just a weird shape in the sky. Yeah. And now you're like, fuck. And I've made the mistake of going down other roads before that are closer to it, and you see warning signs on the street everywhere, like warning, planes overhead and stuff like that, because you look to your right and you realize, oh, that's the strip right there.
Yeah.
I'm at the road that's next to the fence.
And they're loud.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you can feel
I have entire
that.
Days where I can't record because they do air. They're doing like air shows. And I'm like, oh, cool. Just nonstop rocketing sounds are going to happen all day. I guess I'll go to Andrews or something like that.
I remember they did that. They do it very rarely at the base here.
Yeah.
I remember they did it once and it was a fucking
it's so much
nightmare
noise.
Because my house is
for an entire community.
My house is within like
dogs.
A reasonable distance of the base. Like you can get to the Air Force Base in roughly like 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Or so. Well, jets travel pretty fucking fast. So every 5 minutes, you would hear a jet just going over my house. And it's low because the stupid fucking things have to fly low because they're getting close to the base. And so you just... you'd hear like sonic booms going. I'm like, God, stop it. At some point, I was thinking
it's
like...
concerning.
I thought like, please just bomb me. Just let the bombs go.
Bomb me.
Like, I seriously thought in my head, like, this is more...
Because you have the weird anticipation just forever. Like, what is this?
Because you think about it like, okay, a normal person living in a hostile country, you hear that kind of stuff daily, and it's like, oh, okay, yep, the bombs are coming, whatever. But when you live
I
in
I don't
a,
think that's the reaction.
But you know what I mean? Like, when you hear that stuff, you're like, oh, fuck, more conflict, more... You know, like, at some point, a conflict-torn country, you get used
we're
to
here,
certain
we're
stuff.
Like, here, we're stuck in, like, dog mode, where it's like, is this a thing?
Yeah.
Is this a thing?
Like,
is this a thing?
What is this? What is this? What is this? Because
it's never a thing.
Yeah, it's never a thing, but I came to the conclusion, like, it's more terrifying just fly the planes over and never drop a bomb than it is to just drop the bomb. Because the bomb ends the pain of wondering when the bomb's coming. Like, it's more...
I hate the air show stuff just because it has me having this constant thing of, like, what if this is the day they crash?
I think about that for the airplanes, because the jets, I don't care because they're going so fast that even if they crash, they're just going to like fling themselves away from me.
Yeah.
But like the planes, I'm like, if you just plummet, I'm fucked. I can't move my house fast enough to like avoid a plane.
Move my house fast enough.
Like, I can't just get a trailer, pick up the house and go. Like, that plane is devastating. And I like, even to the point where I can't literally take a lot of belongings. Cause it's a plane falling. I gotta move like almost two and a half miles away.
No warning's gonna happen. You're just fucked.
Well, you hear it. I mean, you're gonna hear like.
Yeah, but planes move fast.
Well, yeah, but
way faster than they look like they're moving.
Well, yes, a lot faster than they look like they're moving.
Yes, otherwise they wouldn't be in the air. It occurs to me I never actually explained why I was lucky. Because we got sidetracked on my amazing presentation stories.
Oh, okay.
I never actually discussed how I got through college in my House of Cards luck.
Oh, yeah. I've never explained what I'm going to college for.
Yeah. We have college stuff to get back to. This might be the end of the podcast. It's just that stuff. Yeah. Wow. We went in directions.
We did.
So, My amazing bullshit luck slash good studentness. Right, because I sidetracked on the idea of being a good student, and then we talked about me doing homework the day of, and then we talked about presentations and shit.
Yeah.
So I had good grades all through college, and I didn't have to try for them.
Yes.
Not college, high school. I just didn't ever have to try.
Yes.
Like, I just took to everything easily. I would just remember shit, and I would just... It's almost like I was just firing upon the natural, logical pathways of whatever they're trying to get at and just would move on, yeah. Basically.
American school isn't hard.
It's not hard. It's no, just you follow... just have to do it.
Yeah.
And just... I would just do it. Yeah. And that was it. And I, being a nerd, probably helped because I was just like, eh, the other stuff I'm going to do is either hang out with friends or play video games or whatever. So it's like, the free time spectrum was better than like being like a football player,
yeah.
Or like being somebody who's like forcefully anti-school. So they're going to be going out on weekends to club and drug and shit or whatever the fuck. Like I was boring.
Club and drug and shit.
It's an accurate description.
Well, you make it sound like they go to the clubs to drug people, not go to the clubs to do drugs. Like, when you say it that, I mean, you're not wrong. People did do that, but it's like when you say it that way, you're acting like we had an epidemic at our school of people going to clubs and drugging people.
So, but what also happened right at the end of school is that my parents got divorced. And so,
happy graduation!
Yeah, right, it was around that time. And they were both employed.
Okay.
So that meant that my household income dropped significantly as a result of my parents getting divorced.
Oh, nice.
But I also had great grades because I was on a roll for all of middle school and high school. I don't know if they even look at it in elementary school or whatever. I was in Gates in elementary school. Which was dumb because they just rip you out of classes.
They just rip you out of regular classes.
And you're like, I'm going to miss all my regular class stuff to do this dumb
shit. And my friends.
That seems kind of irrelevant.
Thanks for making me antisocial.
Yeah, that was a mess. Were you ever in... Were you in Gate? I feel like we might have discussed this before.
Yeah.
And because it was... We might have been... Wait, no, we didn't go to the same elementary school, though. Did we? Because I went to this one.
Yeah, I went to this one.
You went to the, yeah. We might have been in Gate together.
Maybe.
As children.
We could have.
We might have been right next to
each other
consistently for all of our childhoods before finally meeting each other after high school was already over.
When did you start Gate?
I think I did it for 5th and 6th grade, so it was 2 years.
I can't remember. I think I did it... I didn't do it for 6th. I know I did it for 5th.
Yeah.
So... Yeah, maybe.
No, when you were in 5th grade, I would have been in 4th grade.
Fourth grade.
So it would have been at the same time.
Yeah.
That would have been amazing to find out that we were literally in the same room as children. That
would have been stupid.
Just continually, like, just parallel to each other until we finally meet after high school's over.
Not related to school at all?
No. No. Weird. No.
Small town problems.
So right off the bat, I had like a double dose of like, I got one, I don't know the difference between grants and scholarships at this point anyway, but I had one type of grant thing for my grades.
Grants you have to pay back, scholarships you don't.
No, you don't.
Well, unless your scholarship paid for your grant.
You don't have to pay for grants.
I thought you had to pay for grants.
You have to pay for loans.
Yeah, and I think grants are...
You never have to pay back grants in anything. Like when you're a scientist and you get a grant, that's just money you get.
What was it they had to pay back?
It's given to you for the purpose of whatever their goal was.
It's not the loan. There's another one you can earn. That's.
I think grants and scholarships have different differences. I think grants might be government and scholarship might be private or something.
Maybe that's what it was.
It might be something like that.
Maybe that's what I was thinking of.
Because when I think of grant, I think of like a scientific, like scientists are like, I have this thing and I want to study this. And it's like, I need to get a research grant. So this will happen. And you don't pay back a research grant. It's just they've decided that you get to do the thing.
Yeah.
So that there's your money. And like that's that also happens for college and stuff like that. But I had one for my grades right off the bat and one for my income level.
Oh.
Because the family's income dropped so much right before.
You didn't do FAFSA for that?
It was like FAFSA related or something. I don't know.
Okay.
I had two separate financial aid things right off the bat. And then so for all of college, I made very little money. I was working at my dad's shop for hourly wage, just doing upholstery all the time and stuff like that. And I had a part-time job at Best Buy that was so part-time, it was like a negligible thing.
You weren't,
Because between me having to commute to a different town and everything like that, and my weird complicated schedule, they would give me like 4 hours every other week sometime. Like, it was like, why haven't you just fired me yet? Is it because you're afraid?
No, because you can get...
they're basically just waiting for me to quit.
Yeah, I think, because they don't want you to get unemployment.
Yeah, they were continually ruining my schedule and trying to get me to quit, I think, was the goal. So that wasn't really helpful for income. But with working for Dad, I was able to make enough money each week to pay for my gas, basically, because I was commuting an hour every day both ways to go to school. So that wasn't great. But midway through, like 2 years through college or something or whatever, I get... And I'll remind you, I went through college longer than normal. It's supposed to be a 4-year degree. I took 5.5 years because I changed midway through.
Right, because
I'm just like I'm just worsening my odds there of getting through here without debt. But halfway through, I get the Smart Senior Grant, which is, I didn't even know existed until it happened at me, which is like, it was like another $2,000 or something like that. Just more money throwing at me for doing good in school or something.
Yeah.
And not having any weird, like, no academic probation, no weird... inappropriate behavior or whatever the fuck, or I don't know.
That matters?
I don't know.
Oh.
I was so bad at doing school or like preparing myself for college that like this was all accidents. Like I didn't do extracurriculars because I was like, I don't like people and I don't want to do these things. Like, my mom kept pushing me to do all these different things and I kept not doing them, basically.
Okay.
And I would just avoid them all at all costs. That one time, I think, and what things I did do are mostly like bullshit. Like, I won an art award, and like I put that on my fucking college shit, and probably helped me out with stuff. But it was like the dumbest shit. Where it was the very first submission on my DeviantArt page is that shitty circle that's like an elemental dumb Photoshop thing. I did it in like 10 minutes probably, and like my art teacher at school saw that and wanted to submit it, and I won first prize for digital art. On a local level for that dumb thing, which is a terrible piece of art that's low resolution and it's just repurposed images and it's not even a clever idea.
Yeah.
But I won a paint set and shit like that and got first prize.
I won a paint set.
The irony of winning a paint set for your digital art thing, because I guess they can't afford programs compared to paint sets.
Can't afford a Wacom tablet to give you?
But like, I had like a bunch of really weak shit in place of where you normally put your extracurriculars you actually did. I was like, I won first prize at this art competition. It was a dumb shit that's like, sounds more impressive than it actually is. And all this dumb shit kept happening where I just kept getting like a grant here or there, or this one thing would work out, or the divorce happened right beforehand, which dropped the income of the family, which made us qualify for things differently. And right when things are starting to dry up and I'm starting to get in trouble of like, oh no, we might run out of college funds soon. My dad marries a disabled vet, which means that I literally don't have to pay for college now because I'm now a dependent of a disabled veteran. So I don't have to pay for college, period.
That is an impressive.
I literally just have to buy the books.
That is an impressive draw. Draw the luck.
Fucking like, I'm like, what the?
That's crazy.
Like, I.
Like, I'm just how like, do you
what,
even?
I'm like, how the fuck? Like, literally, the range of him being not married to married was the exact span of like when I was running out of money for college and everything. And so, like, yeah, I just had to pay for gas and books, and the actual tuition was just waived.
That's crazy. That's crazy fortune.
So, like I didn't fucking. I didn't nail college. Like, I just came out the other side. I was like, I don't have any money.
I got...
Fuck.
I think the only luck... Right? I think the only luck I had was I got lucky.
So when I'm sitting here not using the degree, it's like I lost 5.5 years, but like I didn't...
Also lose any money.
Besides the money in across the way. I don't have negative money.
Yeah. I think the only luck I had was the first time I attempted college back after high school. Mm-hmm. It was, they lured me in with a false promise that you can test out of any class,
mm-hmm.
but then they didn't explain that it was like only one class for your entire degree that you can
any
test out
one
of
class.
Any one class. And I was like, oh, okay.
On the previous topic of like James Franco getting a billion degrees and stuff like that, I imagine part of it is made so much easier by the fact that all the GE is out of the way after the first one in a way.
Yeah.
like you're just taking the major each time over and over again.
Pretty much,
because,
yeah.
Like it's not like the other classes disappear. Like I got to retake them or anything. So it's like you're not.
I got to retake English, like, college English.
It's like stacking 4 huge degrees is not actually stacking 4 year time intervals.
Yeah. And so, so when I ended up leaving that, dropping out of that college, I had taken a loan out to pay for it, but due to a technical error, the bank erased my debt. I went to go pay it one day and the debt was just gone. And I called.
You just didn't know why?
Yeah, it was just gone. Like I went to Access and it says, you don't have any current debt. You have no loans taken out. And I was like,
boy, oh boy.
Okay, so I waited a month and I was like, I guess I'll just not pay it this month. And I went to next month and it was like, still gone. You don't have debt. And I was like, okay. So I waited for an entire year to go by. Mm-hmm. And I finally called them. I said, hey, do I have like any open debts or loans? And they're like, no, you have nothing on your account. Cool. And I was like, $10,000 just gone. Just
Jesus.
Yeah, just gone. I don't know.
I've never.
I don't know where it went.
It's almost like a weird thing that makes me feel like less of an adult somehow, but I've never owed $10,000. I've never owed money.
Yeah. I mean,
ever.
That's like one of the.
I need to get a credit card so I can actually adult at some point by having credit and stuff.
You should have credit.
But I've been so afraid of all the things that ruin people.
Well, I mean, that's.
You pretend to have a credit card by like. Only doing it in really artificial contexts where you're just farming your credit up and not actually using it in your life in any way, which is what I need to start doing. I'm furious at the very concept of.
Oh, I hate credit.
Because of how stupid that is.
Fucking hate credit.
It's like, wow, you sure did that dance for me.
Yeah.
It's like that it was entirely a contained artificial thing. Like it's a fucking vivarium that a salamander lives in. And it's like that's my credit over there.
Like
it's not in the real world.
I built my entire credit.
Although part of me feels like I dodged a bullet by having not being in the credit system when the big security thing happened, where it's just like,
oh yeah,
like I'm just going to join in after that.
Yeah, I got lucky that I just the cheap or the efficient way I did it was I just got a credit card for a local gas station, for not local but like a gas station,
because
that was like a consistent in my life. Yeah, I'll always need gas, so I'll just use it to buy gas and then snacks in the gas station. And then just pay that off, which seemed like the most efficient method because I can't use it anywhere else except for that gas station.
Yep.
So it was like, yeah, I guess, because I can't go use it on the internet. So the worst case scenario is like, oh no, I racked up like $100 in gas bills. I better pay that like I would normally anyways.
Basically.
So it's like the best way to just credit really quickly.
I hate the entire concept.
But the rest of it is shit. Because once you, if anything, so much as like, sneezes on your credit and lowers your score, you are somehow the fucking worst human ever in existence.
Yep.
You go and try to ask for anything like, hey.
Which is fucked because you hear about like documentary stuff where they deal with like, oh yeah, by the way, they're just wrong about who that person was.
Yes.
And they ruined their life.
Yeah.
That just happens all the time.
It happens.
It's like, what the fuck?
Yeah. And you imagine like somebody, say you made one fucking mistake.
They'll just apply debt to the wrong person.
Yeah.
And you can fuck that person's credit. And they're like, what is happening? And then even after it's identified, it doesn't go back.
You legally cannot fix corrupted debt. If debt goes down, there is nothing you can do to make it go back up except for working to get it back up, which is an impressive loophole.
Bad. It's so bullshit. There's so many layers of bullshit.
You know what? It was one of those things where I looked, I finally came to the conclusion that like, this isn't real. Like, we fucked up.
Like, this is a simulation because the systems are too dumb.
It's yes.
Like, it's all like Kingdom Come Deliverance. Like, nothing that doesn't make sense. Why is there a hunger system? Is that there's just a free pot of food every 5 feet?
Yeah.
Like, why are these two things true? This can't be.
It was like, I was sitting there. You know, like people argue, like, we're not in the right timeline. Something got fucked up. I was like, I literally read where it's like, North and South Korea are ending the war against each other. Like, we're done. This is the wrong time. Everything's fucked. I don't know what happened. We need to go back to Earth Prime. We fucked it up somehow. I don't know where we got mixed up along the way, but like we got super fucked on a time stream somehow. It's like, I cannot fathom. I would live to see the end of a conflict that has been mind-numbingly stupid for the past like 100 years. And it's just gonna, and the end result is, well, then Trump gets to meet North Korea. And I was like, what? Why would you? Don't ruin the peace. It's already happened. Why would
What's
you
gonna
do that?
What's he going to do? No, there's just a...
What do you think he's going to do? He's
going
to...
World politics. Every time you look at world politics, it's definitely like, oh, look, another conflict where it's really hard to even define why it's happening. And it affects everyone horribly forever. And we could just stop. But no.
I just get...
And I'm like, oh, fuck.
I just get confused about the end goal.
The end goal is to hopefully not all die. Which we do by constantly threatening to die.
But yeah, like it's like someone has a gun and is holding the gun to somebody's head who's holding a gun to you, and they're like, but I'm gonna kill your family. And it's like, I mean, well, I'm gonna kill your family. It's like,
I mean, now,
well,
we're,
then I'm gonna
now
kill.
We're just being smug aliens.
But
now
but,
we're just being those smug aliens in every sci-fi show where it's like, this is how humanity are like evil monkeys that all murder each other. Why would we ever talk to this savage race?
But it's true.
It's like, thank you, sci-fi author.
But it's isn't
who's
it,
abstracting their argument through a weird filter.
Is it not true though? At some point, I mean, when you ask yourself,
that,
like, why did you bomb that country?
It is
because
true
it makes that other country not like be afraid of us. But
it's,
what
it's
about
true
the
that
people
we have
there?
Like 500 conflicts that are literally not worth, where the reason for the conflict is not worth the actual toll of the conflict.
No.
And it's not a reasonable thing to do.
We constantly we use
it's like on a,
middle.
It's like the, I was listening to You Are Not So Smart on the way here, and like, it's, that's just the name of the podcast.
Yeah, it's just,
and their pod, the episode was about, one of the topics they touched upon was how like progress hurt people, essentially. Like, the Renaissance era was worse than the Middle Ages for the average person because the increased trade led to increased disease, and the increased economy, increased power of everyone who was in power led to, like, better weapons, larger wars, and stuff like that. And, like, that part in particular, I'm looking at, like, the better, the more tools there are for war, the more war will just happen.
Well, yeah.
Because
I mean,
they can.
The easier it is to kill somebody, why wouldn't you just kill
somebody?
Because
they're not the ones that have to do it.
Yeah.
Fucking war pigs, Black Sabbath. Like, why don't politicians... politicians have themselves to blame? We're only fighting their own war.
Yeah. You could also do a surge.
Why don't presidents fight in wars?
Yeah.
Something something send the poor. BYOB.
Yeah, BYOB is one. He also made
bring your own bombs. Is what's supposed to be short
bring,
for
yeah,
in that
it's
case.
Bring your own bombs.
It's like, yeah, it sure is easy for these wars to keep happening when they're like a video game to you, asshole.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's. I think the for me, the thing that really is the thing I hate the most is the like third party conflicts, like where we and this other country are just not jiving, but we can't talk to each other. So we're going to go destroy the shit out of this random country.
We can't talk to
and,
each other.
Because we can't. We can't go head to head and just be like, knock the fuck off, I'm going to beat your ass.
You're talking about like Russia,
like
United
us or
States,
Russia,
proxy
us
wars,
or China.
The proxy wars.
Every proxy war is literally just stupid. There's no reason to bring innocent, not like not involved. Like these people are not Russian citizens or American citizens. And they're just being bombed. And they're just like,
well,
why?
Yeah, their entire concepts that don't actually make any logical sense beyond, like, the moon territory that politicians live in.
Yes. But it baffles me when you think about that. Because, like, what if someone just decided that, you know, Washington, D.C. just happened to be a country where a good proxy war would happen? And it's like, you know, you think
a very
about
different reality.
But I'm saying, you think about it in that grandstanding where it's like, what if someone just chose one of your states and decided to just bomb it because they didn't like China? You'd be a little upset about it, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you just kind of, I don't know, grow animosity towards the person who did that to you and ultimately come back and try to do some kind of damage to him later in life because you're being a piece of shit? I don't know. I wasn't alive during the Gulf War, but maybe that might be why Al-Qaeda came back and hit us in the ass. But I'm not a historian. I just read the books you told me I had to read by law. Like, what the fuck? Like, seriously, I get so mad when I see politicians do shit. I'm like, did you not go to the same school I did and read the same damn fucking books I did? Because this one clearly...
It is really fascinating when high top-level politicians can't process basic historical information that we are required by law to learn.
Required by law!
In our government institution schools with the books about the history... Our government writes its own history and then doesn't know it.
Yeah, they don't. And the excuse that upsets me more is that, like, well, it's been a while. These people have been on fucking Congress for 40 years. What do you mean they forgot? They were the ones who approved it.
A lot of them were
there.
Yeah,
like, they were there when it happened. It's like, you know, it's like, you see, like...
Some of them have been around for so fucking long. Like, I talked about the Watermelon Girl thing before.
Yeah.
And, like, that movie was decades ago. And it, and the horrible irony about it, this thing, about, like, this, her, about, like, these silenced, like, black voices, was that her movie was seen as being this vulgar, horrible, sexual thing, and she was ultimately being silenced by white politicians because there was, like, a senator that was, like, taking her movie to task and trying to silence and mute her and stop this from happening and everything. And Kyle's distressing point in that video is that he's still there now. He's there right now. He's like, here, and I made the connection when he put it out. Like, he's like, here's him being racist. Here's him being a coward. Here's him being a coward and a racist. And then, like, oh fuck, it's that guy I see on the news all the time. Shit. Shit. He's been around forever. Everyone's around forever. They never leave.
Yeah.
They've been in this. All the people that currently run our government, besides the one person we put all our attention to, are people that have been there since before I was born.
Yeah.
Like, fuck.
There are people in Congress right now who literally approved the Korean War and who are going to still be in Congress and see the resolution of the Korean War. A thing that I was born into had already happened, and I will see the resolution into it. One that I was told all my childhood that it will never be done. Like, the Koreas will never be friends.
Do you think there's a genuine problem in the United States that, like, the president of the United States is too much of a spectacle?
Yes.
Like, he's too hype.
Yes.
Like, just the very concept of a president is such an event every 4 years that it's all we think about.
Well, because
we literally just ignore the fact that
because it happens every 4 years.
Our lives we don't leave.
Well, because we can't vote on new Congress members. They have to be, remember, they have to be appointed.
No.
Or that judges.
No, they're all voted on.
So, yeah, it's
all every voted. Single one of them is voted on. That's why it's a problem.
No,
is that we're just not paying attention.
I meant Supreme Court judges.
And the problem.
Which is another problem too.
No, it speaks. Well, yeah, the courts, the judges are a whole different thing. But it's part to just not have them all be elected by people. It was an idea because they were afraid of people when they were making our government. Basically.
Well, I don't think it was afraid. I think it was like looking down on people. Well, like, yeah, peasants, like, making rules.
It's why we're a republic and not a democracy, is because of that.
It's a democratic republic, Keith.
Where the Democrats and Republicans fight.
Well, we're allowed to vote.
I've heard that be a real argument. Like, the Democrats are a dumb party because we're a republic. They're wrong. And that's why they're wrong. It's like an actual conversation I've heard before. And I'm like, dude, they're just dumb names. They've literally switched positions over the years.
I'm sorry. Did you want the big wigs to be back? Because that was a party back in the day.
It was a party called the Whigs.
Fucking stupid ass motherfucker.
The Whigs and the Tories. And the
there was like 12 of them. What happened to them?
It's probably better.
Well, yeah, it was.
That's one of the problems, that not only is the president such a spectacle as an idea, but like also we're split into two parties so consistently that ever all these different spots where some asshole sticks around forever is because it's that guy. It's like, sure, that guy's been ruining our government for the last 40 years, but I'm not going to nominate a Republican or a Democrat or whatever the other one is that's not him. It's like, oh, that's why they get to stay here forever and be like then, societal poison.
And it becomes,
it's because the competition's automatically just deemed worse no matter what.
Yes.
And I'm like,
and
oh,
the worst part too is that you have this situation where Congress is literally every fucking election fighting to hope they have the majority for so they can streamline their bills without conflict, which is a terrifying thing to think about happening in any government, is that there is a party that wishes to have full control so they can do what they please with no opposition. Which is literally how democracy doesn't work. Like, that's not how democracy works, is that you just have full control, no one has a say in it, fuck you. Like, that's...
Now everything is just sad. Welcome to Sit and Discuss on the Sad Games.
I just don't... The thing.
Welcome to the rebirth of Sadcast.
I just don't understand. Like, I don't... There are two things I will never understand in the world.
We don't no questions this week.
Nope.
We'll get to them next week. There's only a couple of them anyway, so...
The only thing I never understand in this world is why anybody would want to become president.
Because they're a sociopath.
Is it? I thought they just liked the attention.
Well, they're narcissistic sociopaths.
Okay.
I'm just saying that, like...
I mean...
I'm saying that almost across the board, if you're somebody who... not only wants to be that position, but also can get through all the stages in between to get there, you're probably not a good person.
Ironically, yes.
Yeah.
Like, you're the leader of the world, but not a good person.
No matter who you are, to get through the shit you go through to get to that stage, I think you just have to be not a great person at that point.
Which begs the question of why?
It's all distressing.
Why even? Why don't we just have a mascot?
Why don't we have a mascot?
Like, what is the point?
Are you talking like the queen?
Yeah.
The queen's not elected in the first place.
No, but what is...
They have elected officials in the UK.
Well, yeah, but
in England.
The point I'm saying is, why do we even have a figurehead? Is it necessary to have one person doing fuck all?
Well, it's supposed to be the three branches, but no one remembers what the president does anymore, and the president also just keeps making powers.
Yeah, the president is just a loose cannon who then just kind of...
It's supposed to be, here's the people that make laws, here's the guy that says yes.
He literally,
or no.
The president...
And here's the guy that says on second thought,
yeah.
That's supposed to be the whole system, but instead this one guy's like, I just make wars happen, and I make policies basically, and I'm just, but also don't, but also do, really do.
It's like, yeah.
And I think part of it is the incentive structure of, like, it's such a high profile election that you have the argument of, like, public opinion being in favor of your side. And so that's why the president can sort of demand things of the parliament, and then they will actually lead to them making said things, is because he has clout behind him that many others don't.
So just get rid of him. Like, seriously, because all he does is represent our country. But if you elect someone who doesn't actually represent us as a whole and makes us look worse, then we can't do anything about it for 4 years. So 4 years, everyone looks at us like an idiot.
I mean, no matter what, there's going to be somebody on top.
Which is why you just put a figurehead. You just put a nothing. Somebody who doesn't...
You always end up with somebody on top, because even within...
No, you just have a Congress. You have a group of people.
That's the thing, is even in Congress, there's like... You have the speaker and stuff like that.
Well, yeah, but the UN does that, and it's fine.
Yeah, but I mean, those people are just... They just basically become the president.
Well, no, they...
functionally in our society.
Well, I mean, all you do is you just make... you make their rules to not be... They don't have any more power than Congress does. Their only power is to basically
be the leader of Congress.
Well, it's to keep Congress on track.
Mm-hmm.
That's their power. The power to say, like, guys...
Turns out to be a lot of power.
Well, yeah, but it also is kind of nice, because sometimes I'm tired of talking about laws that aren't going to happen for, like, 30 years, and then someone goes, like, can we put it on hold? And then we just never get back to it. Because that's, like, a really cool system I like. And then they go back to the bill, like, you know, after it's been 30 years, and they're like, yeah, let's just approve this, but never update anything in it for weird reasons, and then that happens.
Stop getting into all the depressing guts of our country and how nothing works or makes sense.
Well, one thing works.
No.
Any citizen can own a gun and kill each other with them.
How do you even end this podcast?
You end this podcast.
I'm off this podcast. It's over. Send your questions to sitanddiscusspodcast@gmail.com. If it's about politics, I'm just going to delete it. This whole podcast was a mistake.
If you have any political complaints about us, do it in the Discord, so we can ignore you easily.
So that you can argue with Naya about something. I don't know.
About something.
She'll bring up bread.
It'll be Naya, XRM, and Daydev will show up, and you will, and sometimes Thomas, and you'll have a giant political powwow, and you'll have fun.
Oh God.
But if it gets too rowdy, we're going to throw you in, like, the Disgusting Scumlords page.
I can't do political debates, because I'm just already exhausted by the number I've dealt with in person. And I can't do them on the internet, because it's like, I can't argue with all of these people individually. There's hundreds of you.
I just...
And also online, when you argue with somebody about politics, they're usually arguing about a fake version of you. And not actually listening to anything you say, so
exactly.
It's not really a conversation.
That's why I always argue as a fake person every time, because there's no reason. Because if their fake inversion of me is this ridiculous lunatic who thinks, like, gassing every single person on the planet is the best.
Kill all the babies.
Yeah, like, if I just say kill every child and the ones that survive are strong enough to survive or are allowed to live, then, you know, like...
Just gas every single child with nerve toxin until we find the ones that are immune and we make a super race nerve toxin immune.
I want only the children that were smart enough to climb on top of their brothers and dead brothers and sisters
Jesus,
and survive
above. It's getting so much worse.
But you see, see the point I'm making is that, like, if you argue in that fashion, when someone tries to argue with you, they're like, I don't even understand. Where are you being genuine? It's like, no, because it's dumb. Like, I don't need to argue with you. It's not necessary.
We just keep rolling the dice. Is this the one that'll make people angry? Let's find out.
I don't feel like we insulted anybody.
I've been so surprised about when people get angry, I can't even tell anymore.
So
the continual of not that happening on the podcast has just been weird.
That's true. I won't apologize, by the way, for my Malcolm X. I won't apologize.
I mean, you...
That's the only thing I can remember
I said. I'm the person who, like, was playing Witcher, and somebody was like, you want to see my scars? And I was like, ew. And they're like, are you shaming people who get a C-section to save their life? And I'm like, what the fuck is happening right now? So, like, the number of reasons people have gotten mad at me for reasons that I was like, I don't even, what happened? How did we get here? And then the number of, like, the lack of outrage on this podcast has been confusing by comparison.
I think because at this point people realize that it's just, like, all good and well.
Is this podcast listened to by the 400 people that have been immunized by you already?
Maybe. It could
and
be
everyone
possible.
Else sees you in the thumbnail is like, hey.
I can only hope. You're all learning to come to understand exactly my mentality.
See you guys next time.
See you guys. I won't
Goodbye.
Be here. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Did you say you won't be here?
No, I said I won't be. I was going to say I won't be dressed up this nicely next time.
I was going to say, like, you're not out of here yet.